globalism.
The era of economic surrender will finally be over.
We will no longer surrender this country or its people to the false song of globalism.
They have gotten the political establishment and the media establishment to become pure, wanton henchmen of totalitarianism.
If you were a foreign power looking to weaken America, you couldn't do better than Hillary Clinton's economic agenda.
I think what the Chinese have done is really smart.
The skyscrapers went up in Beijing and many other cities around the world, while the factories and neighborhoods crumbled right here in Detroit.
It's all training us to accept less, lowering expectations, a post-industrial world, a new dark age. That's what the UN Biological Diversity Assessment 1996 calls for.
When we abandoned the policy of America first, we started rebuilding other countries instead of our own.
Not a world, Winston, that gets more beautiful and more technological and stronger. A world that gets uglier and stupider and more stunted.
The government should allow Hillary Clinton to become president of the United States.
I voted for Hillary Clinton.
Well, I voted for Hillary. I guess I have to since I'm working for her as well.
You want an image of the future, Winston? It's a boot stomping on a human face forever.
Muslims are peaceful and tolerant people and have nothing whatsoever to do with terrorism.
Women are treated, discriminated against in all of these countries she took money against. Gays and lesbians are either executed or punished severely. They're mistreated. She claims to be their champion.
Don't look at me, Winston, and see the black circles around my eyes and see how ugly and weak I am, expressing myself and dying, and I torture people 18 hours a day, and I have a horrible life. That's the beauty of the satanic evil of the priest of power ripping apart humanity. We're here to hurt humans. We're here to suck your guts out.
We now take you live to the Central Texas Command Center in the heart of the resistance.
And which Republican candidate has the best chance of winning the general election?
Of the declared ones right now, Donald Trump.
Obama will go down as perhaps the worst president in the history of the United States! Exclamation point. At real Donald Trump. Well, at real Donald Trump. At least I will go down as a president.
Because a vision softly creeping.
You're awake, by the way. You're not having a terrible, terrible dream. Also, you're not dead and you haven't gone to hell. This is your life now. This is our election now. This is us. This is our country. It's real.
I'm literally about to kill myself, and I'm not kidding. You better fix it right now.
He wants to cut my taxes to zero.
In her lifetime,
that's why the country has all this wealth.
Female president.
So bad. Spirit cooking. Why can't we have a devil worship our leader? We found the female edge Krelex in Austin. They actually do that.
I continue to believe.
Red hammer and sickle flags. We wish we were in North Korea starving. Ah, get out of the cell phones and all the money and jobs. Ah, we hate it. Ah, we're lazy. There's so little food. We all weigh 400 pounds. Ah, ah. We kicked our daddies and out. We're all girls. We're going to run things now. And our witch queen didn't help us.
Ah, ah, ah. I'm triggered.
We'll be back. To be clear, Tuesday night into Wednesday morning, I did celebrate on air. And yesterday, after I had about 2.5 hours of sleep, I did celebrate on air. But I said, look, just as night follows day, George Soros and the globalists are going to go into high gear and they're going to launch riots all over the country. And they're going to intensify this racial division crap. And we need to really get on the offense about this and get very, very aggressive. Because it is outrageous how criminal this is to literally have the paid buses that come in with the white graduate student agitators. And it's true. They're all white, basically. We have it on video all over the United States. My crew has got it themselves in more than 15 cities. We've done whole pieces on it. And they're the ones saying, deck the halls with dead cops. They're the ones saying, you know, all this crap. And you have professional government-funded and corporate-funded, university-funded agitators that are leading mobs of idiots. And it is absolutely seditious. This is not free speech. And I'm not saying shut down the general public's speech. I'm saying when you have paid agitators of multinational groups that have been banned in countries all over the world, the State Department got caught sending these people into Russia to try to overthrow Russia, and they would have press conferences on C-SPAN and CNN, and they would admit, we're trying to overthrow Russia. I mean, no wonder Russia's upset with the United States. This is a multinational global system trying to overthrow us and trying to overthrow Russia. That's why there's this solidarity, folks. We're in World War IV. It's an economic, psychological warfare operation. You have to understand something. This is not my opinion. This is from the textbooks, from the battle plans. I want to explain something to the leftists and their minions and all the rest of you, okay? Number one, you're not leftist. Number two, you are absolutely nothing but useful idiots manipulated with a corporate template that's basically identical worldwide and that's used in the middle class so that people are and stupid and under globalist control. This is their admitted plan under the Royal Commission in 1949. And everything after that is a regurgitation. Cloward and Piven. Just all of this stuff where they admit we want you austere. We want you not having anything so we can permanently control you. In Tragedy and Hope, Carol Quigley writes about this in a book, a secret book for the State Department and CIA that was later published. None of this is my opinion. Now, the media is continuing to freak out saying, oh my God, the president of the United States follows Alex Jones's worldview. No, that's not what's happening. As much as I'd love to say that Donald Trump's getting his information from me, maybe 10% of it, he's not. He's getting it from top generals. He's getting it from top people in banking. Because, folks, if you actually read globalist publications, they admit all this. They just put their spin on it that it's good. So the reason people are so frightened hearing Donald Trump like the mouth of Alex Jones is it's not. I'm the first person nationally to actually break all this down and roll out how it really works. This isn't my perspective on things. The globalists are selling this soft, stupid race division, sex division, nanny state, political correctness garbage. And they're selling a system of more student loans and more debt and more, you know, payday loan facilities and more rental centers and more permanent renter class. That's their admission. Huge screw jobs where you pay more for a 200 square foot apartment than you do for a 1,000 foot because the city passes a law. They've done it now 8 different major cities. Austin's one of them. To rip you off, they go, look, it's liberal. We just screwed you. Hardcore. You're like, thank you. It's trendy to live in a coffin and pay more than a 1,000 foot square. They have you paying more for a jail cell than a normal sized decent apartment. That's one microcosm. They are there to screw you to the wall. And in WikiLeaks, they're foaming at the mouth about how much they hate you and how stupid you are and how they want to make you poor and keep you in the dark. That fundamentally pisses Donald Trump off. It fundamentally pisses me off. So listen, I don't deserve the credit. Everybody's trying to give it to me right now. We have the credit for having energy and knowing humanity could win and turn the tide. And we're just beginning to do that. But you know who gets the credit? The people from the Renaissance, 500 years ago, we are all just rediscovering the better parts of civilization. We're now discovering the real engine of growth and prosperity and independence and diversity and freedom and true liberalism. what we have been fighting is the counterfeit. So if you look at what Trump's doing, you look at what Trump's saying and what he's promoting 90% of the time. He does some stuff I don't like. The Renaissance, the new enlightenment, freedom, free market, everything that made us great, innovation. That's what's happening. And they're selling this whole disease narrative, and they're delusional, all buying into this cult mentality in the major media, in the major corporations, in these major systems, that they really believe delusionally that they were invincible and they were unstoppable, but they don't even have a culture to push. Globalism doesn't want you to have any type of culture. Well, an empty culture of infighting and being alone and hating everyone and not having a family and not having a tribe, that's never going to sell up against the American system. And that's why for the last 240 plus years, it has been the main design of every major corporate imperial empire, from the British East India Company to the British Empire itself, and then modern inculcations, the economic progeny of those systems, to shut it down and create a worldwide monopoly control grid owned by less than six major combines. And that's what they admit they're building. And you have these poor little leftists who, if you ask them, well, are you for TPP? If they know what it is, they'll say no. Well, Trump's against it too, but Hillary's for it. They're not living in the real world. They go to their university. They have the little change agent graduate student who's been handling them since the day they got off the bus with zits on their face and are scared at college. And they go, come on here into this area. You know, there's a lot of racist here and a lot of rape here and a lot of bad things. You need to be scared. You're literally being marched into a cult. And then they inflict you. They inflict you with mental illness. They inflict you with a chip on your shoulder. And then you've got the arrogant frat, you know, people that hate the frat next door to them. And there's some racism going on there. And then the more you fight with them, the more they fight with you and then hate you. And now we've all been balkanized like a big prison. Everybody put in their little areas. And now we can all be manipulated and controlled. And that's where this whole thing is going. So if the mainstream media wants to know why they have 6% trust rates, and that was before this election, it's because you have no credibility. Your polls were all fake. You got caught with your pants down. We've been proven right in spades. Ladies and gentlemen, I talk to folks across the political spectrum. I talk to heavy hitters. I was checking every day. Trump was ahead at the end of the RNC in July by almost 20 points in every major poll. The elite were crapping themselves. So they started adding 20, 30, 40 points, remember, to those polls to make Hillary look like she was ahead. That closed it some with the public because of the perception he was losing big, but only to about 10 points. Remember how many times I told you this? Hundreds of times. The New York Times and others made big jokes and go, Alex claims there's these internal polls and he always falls back on that. Yes, there were real polls done where they just didn't add 20% more Democrats and Trump was always winning. And now you see the exact numbers I told you. In fact, he would have won even bigger. He had a landslide sea change electoral win. He did not have that when it came to popular vote. But if you go into the states, we had Bev Harris, the big Democrat, on yesterday, top elections expert. She said clearly they stole it from Trump and then she listed, what was it, five states. Because it would have been a hammer blow of biblical proportions, probably the biggest landslide in this country's history, if they wouldn't have stolen all those different counties. So, ladies and gentlemen, that's what happened here. And we're sitting here on the verge of the globalist counterstrike, which is going to be economic. I know he's there saying build the wall. He's going to meet the White House today and then meet with Republican leaders who will try to, you know, tell him to get in line. It's going to be a battle between the will of Donald J. Trump and these people. And we have to be behind Trump in his constitutional agenda and support him, because they're always going to put the narrative out. He can't control himself. He doesn't know what he's doing. Oh, it's his fault the stock market fell. On and on and on. Notice the stock market's actually up right now. And Wall Street, the general traders were chanting, lock her up. We're going to play that after this break. Because the general Wall Street gets it. It's the big mega Wall Street, only four or five big firms that control most of the show. And they've been consolidating control over banking and over stocks and over everything else, making it harder for the little guys and middle-sized guys, and even big guys who aren't part of the inside club to operate. So there's a lot of different revolutionary forces here that if you look at the globalist structure, we have a very good chance of turning this around. But this is a total culture war, not the one they want to have where it's you're black or you're white or you're Hispanic or you're Asian, but a culture war over, do you want lower taxes? Do you want more prosperity? Do you want the American system? Or do you want Venezuela or North Korea? Because historically, despite what your professors and change agents are telling you, this system never delivers to you. It only delivers to those that want a monopoly. So we've got a bunch of clips I want to play today. A lot of guests coming on the broadcast as well. Such a historic time to obviously be alive. But it's painful to see not just Van Jones Tuesday night coining the term, but now it's been picked up all over the networks that this was a white lash. Actually, I have the numbers right here. Trump did better than Romney among Hispanics and blacks massively. Massively. See, that's folks that actually ever got to hear him speak or who have real jobs and live in the real world and aren't just college students or Bernie Sanders supporters who aren't living in the real world. That's what they're scared of, because if he can unify everybody and bring everybody into the Tea Party movement, it's game over for the globalists, folks, because this will spread worldwide. Again, America will become the leader of promoting true freedom. Two systems that don't coexist in history very well. Conquering systems, exploitive systems, and freedom-based innovative systems. And every culture's been a mix of those. The United States, you can go look at its barbarous past and terrible things that have been done. Then why did everybody want to move here, and why was it such a game changer? Because the limited developments in freedom were light years ahead of what anybody else had done and became the model of the world. The good aspects of the Republic are what the globalists want to remove and bring in ancient, total imperial control. You look at globalism, it's the return of the kings. It's the corporate kings. It's like the 1970s Rollerball movie with James Caan, writ large. That's what they're establishing in their own words. That's why they made movies about it, throwing it in your face. This is what they're setting up, and it's anti-human, it's anti-freedom. Now, that said, this is history, this is a huge victory, but the fight is just beginning. He has to go in and let those Republicans know. I have the people behind me. I have a mandate. You've seen the media collapse. You've seen the Republican establishment. You've seen everything they have thrown at Trump. And if they try to block him, he is going to absolutely, in the next election, remove all of them. He could start with major moves for recalls. It's time for the president to use his power with the people to mobilize them, because Paul Ryan and all these people, they want the power structure for themselves. And Trump is not going to sit there and sell favors to them to go along with him. That's why they're so angry. And the stock market, you notice, they tried to plunge it to scare everybody. And we've looked at it. The open market committee of the president's not in there propping it up. But guess what? It's going up just as small investors, medium-sized, and others are jubilant. Look at drudgereport.com. Trump rocks market, investors exuberant. And then there's all these economists, including liberal ones, going, you know what, actually, if he does what he says he's going to do, it's a super good plan. This is a guy that finishes most of his hotels 50% early and under budget. I mean, I guess it's the Scott in him, and he admits that he's an absolute penny pincher and ball buster. And just get ready, globalists, because Trump is coming after you. You have been pissing on this country forever. And it's going to stop. And that's why there's such this exuberance in Russia, because, again, they've been under the very same corporations and banks that are squatting on top of us right now. Does that mean if we kick the globalists out, everything's going to be fine? No. And the globalists own so much and control so much, they're still going to be there, still going to be wealthy, still be owning almost everything. It's just they're not going to squeeze out the last few factories, the last few jobs, and make us all live in coffin apartments and not have cars and not have vacations. They admit they want to permanently end us, saying we're hurting the earth. Then you get rid of your jumbo jets first. No, you want to conquer us. You want to rub out people with prosperity, and it ain't happening. And that's why They're saying lock her up, chanting on the stock market. And CNN, MSNBC, and others don't know what to do. MSNBC, you name it, because it's dawning on them, we really are hated. We really don't have power. You see, as they got exposed, and as the media got totally exposed as active shills against the American people, not just well-meaning liberal idiots, as it came out, they were a lockstep military operation run by George Soros, run by the White House and Hillary. They've gone from being reviled to absolutely hated forever. That means any sponsors associated with you. It means your families, everybody. You are anathema. You are the enemy. And I've been talking to folks, their husbands, their wives are saying, turn against this. Don't be part of this. Everybody hates us now. The neighbors all hate us. Everyone's turning against us. That illusion that was there that they were large and in charge and unstoppable, and we had to just accept the will of Harvard and accept the will of the LA Times, the New York Times, and just accept the will and use what words they said, and mother and father are bad, and the state runs our kids, and forced inoculations, and GMO's good for you, and we're going to launch all these wars, but it's okay because we're liberals, and we're going to arrest a bunch of reporters for no reason. People have turned against you. And it's a lot worse than you even think, delusionals. So you're saying, oh my gosh, Alex Jones's narrative, it's taken over. It's not my narrative. It's the return of Americana. It's the return of the most successful system the world's ever seen, dumbasses. You didn't fully extinguish it out. And now it's going to come roaring back like the phoenix. Let's go out to break with them chanting, lock her up.
My colleague, Carl Quintanilla, and I'm reading this and on the trading floor of the New York Stock Exchange, according to Carl Quintanilla, people were booing, shouting, lock her up. These are the Wall Street people,
right.
Some individuals. I mean, we know it wasn't the entire room, but it was enough that Carl Quintanilla, a responsible journalist, this is what was happening.
And then we're going to come back. We're actually digging it up. But there it is. Again, where'd lock her up come from? Where'd Hillary for President come from? Again, we'll be right back. Stay with us.
We're on the march. The Empire's on the run.
Told you we're on the march.
Alex Jones and the CCN Radio Network.
I told you. We are the winners. Let's look at some of the headlines up on drudgereport.com and also Infowars.com. Analysis: Trump would have beaten Obama in 2012. The New World Order is in trouble. Mainstream media has a big article out on that. World government is in trouble. That the leaders of world government are panicking, even though world government doesn't exist. It's kind of like death panels being in the Obamacare bill or the IRS giving you $5,000 fines, but it also doesn't exist. That's the racist Alex Jones saying that. Oh, where was I racist? We don't care. It's a magic word. We use it over and over again. We're so intellectual. No, they know that their audience are a bunch of buffoons who just hear that word and like pee-pee on themselves. You know, like you come in a room or something, a little dog is scared of you and it doesn't know you, and he's kind of like, psst. I mean, it's just like, you know, Obamacare is meant to really hurt the economy and screw you. Big megabanks wrote it and they're laughing at you. Here's Gruber that wrote it saying he thinks you're an idiot and it's meant to triple your prices. No, racist. Psst. It's like, okay, all right. Literally, we have footage, but they're cussing so much we can't play it because it would just be nothing but beeps of what we call the New Age Skrillex discovered. These two women. There's a bunch of them out there. This is just in downtown Austin. 2 days before the election, screaming and screaming and screaming like they're being murdered, like they have just found dead children. I mean, it is the most hysterical, out of their mind, just, he's a homophobe, he wants to hurt the gay man. And then he's like, well, when did he say that? Sounds like a cat fight. This is just at the start. And they just inflict and infect these women's brains with scientific warfare. And then they teach all the men to walk around and act real beta and then like prostrate themselves before the women and go, I'm beta, I'm beta. And then the woman's totally mad because there's no real men around, but she doesn't know why. Subconsciously, she hates men, but she really loves them. You ought to see these social justice warrior women, though, man, because when you really start arguing with them and laughing at them and smiling, they start getting really excited. Their cheeks get all red. They're like, oh. I'm like, just as a test, give me your phone number. And they're like, oh, maybe. And I was like, oh, yeah, that's what I thought. Listen, sweetheart, did you not have a daddy at home? I'm sorry you didn't. And I'm not saying that mean. It's just so sad that they think the state is their daddy. And they see a big orange-headed toad hopping around that just wants to cut their taxes and empower the country. And they're scared of it. They're scared of Americana. And that's what Donald Trump is. A big, fat slice of it. A big, ridiculous slice of it. America is ridiculous. It's big. It's rich. It's opportunities. It's decadence. I'm not even saying it's all good. But it's better than what the New World Order wants. The big orange toads, a lot better than weirdo billionaires devil-worshipping, bringing little kids to party where they simulate drinking blood. Let me see. People doing that and saying they want to make us poor and they hate us in the WikiLeaks, or someone that openly wants to hire minorities and put them in charge of major operations and create wealth. Well, that's a very horrible person. Under $40,000 a year, he's trying to get a bill passed for, where you pay zero tax. I've seen people with $40,000 paychecks. There's some of them in this office, and I've seen, as I sign the checks, what's being taken out of them. $10,000 a year? You don't want to keep that? Okay, I'm sorry. That's what that big, fat, orange toad wants to do. By the way, I don't mean that meanly. I kind of call myself a toad. So that's like a nickname that my parents have for me. I've had it for a while. My kids call me the toad. So it's a very endearing thing. But you have to look at Trump. He is quite like a magical, large, golden toad hopping around. And, they just don't know why they can't beat him. It's like Diller, the big globalist media guy, said he has a magical evil behind him. No, buddy. It's called not wanting to screw people over. That's what it is. That's why they try to brand him constantly as wanting to screw everybody. Because the truth is, he just does hard-nosed deals with big corporations, and they know it and don't like it because he did it his way. You know the Frank Sinatra song? I did it my way. That's what Trump's done. All right, let's stop right there. I want to start getting to these clips, but before I do that, here's the really sad stuff. We have a stack of videos here, and I've met reports more of this happening in Austin. It's very, very sad, and it's meant to elicit a prison culture where if there's enough racial attacks on white people, it's going to create a big racist backlash when 90% of Hispanics and blacks and other folks are not foaming at the mouth racists that want to beat you up in a parking lot. But I pulled into a Dutch Shell yesterday and had two different people who knew who I was kind of bug their eyes out at me. And one guy started going like this. And I just went, standing by my car, just went, okay. And the guy walked off. I guess I wasn't like a woman or some little person. I mean, I'm not the toughest guy around. I'm an old guy these days, but he's a pretty big black guy. But I was just like, all right, man. Jump on top of him, put his head in the concrete the second he moves at me. I didn't want to hurt him, but I'm going to put him down. I just got to start carrying a gun at all times. That's a really sad part, but that's it. I'm carrying all the time now. Just because I'm just going to try to get in my car. People try to attack me. I'm not even going to engage him. I'm not going to be the big tough guy I was when I was 20. I'm just going to try to get back and just say, stay back. And because I'm not looking for any trouble. And I don't want to hurt these zombies, but man, I tell you, they've been brainwashed. And I had a black guy bow up. And Hispanic guy, pretty wild-eyed, and then the guy behind the counter when I'm sitting there getting my Gatorade. I know Gatorade's crappy, but I give myself a treat occasionally. I like how orange Gatorade tastes. And he was like, man, things are crazy, yeah. He's like, yeah, yeah. And I'm like, yeah, it's horrible. Trump wants to cut everybody's taxes. And he goes, I like it. But man, it's scary. People are pissed. And this is in South Austin. And I'm like, whoa, I guess I... See, I'm the type of guy that goes in and eats barbecue in East Austin and hangs out and, you know, likes to go to blue-collar areas. What it'll cause is me not to do that. See, and that then isolates everybody, and we're now in our prison. And that's what DrudgeReport.com has linked. Shock video from Chicago, and there's videos pouring in across the country. Police cars getting burned, things being blown up, people being killed, you name it. A shock video, black mob viciously beats white Trump voter. And it's all on tape. We're going to be playing that. And you got folks on national TV saying, you know, we need to kill these people. People have to die. Anti-Trump protester calls for violence on CNN. And then I was talking to some of the crew here this morning, and they said, well, no, one fellow works here, lives next door to a cab driver who got attacked by two Hispanic males and mugged. And they got the license plate. The guys even got arrested later. And they said, we're going to beat you up because you're white. And the person's like, white? They go, Trump. He started beating him. But of course, robbing. See, most criminals aren't pure sociopaths, so they want to think what they're doing is right and okay. And that's what I wanted to say here. Think about how the mainstream media is and what you've done. Like Putin said, look what you've done putting Al-Qaeda in charge of Syria, killing 300 plus thousand people. It's like 400,000 last time I checked, but 200 plus thousand are Christians. Look what you've done for no reason, just to be evil. And now you're really up there on TV going, racist KKK has taken the country. He's going to deport everyone and kill everyone and enslave you and hurt you. And he hates women. And he hates gays and all this made up or exaggerated or twisted stuff. And then a bunch of people, whether they be white, black, Hispanic, that are kind of the desperate-eyed lottery ticket mentality, just get into the hype and go, I'm mad then. I'm going to go out and do something. And I look at these photos and videos of the women that are out protesting. It's like 70% women in most cases. They look totally desperate, scared, but well-fed in this horrible country, just stumbling around, bitching, totally just screaming and yelling in a bunch of mindless hysteria. And what are they doing? They're ensuring that the incredible altruism and Christian edict to try to mop up classism, statism, racism that was the greatest in this country anywhere in history. You go, well, I was taught in school was the worst. That's why, folks. Because it was the idea and it was building. They have to destroy that. So they're creating the total division right now. They're doing it right now. Destroying Martin Luther King's dream right now so they can rule us by the great game, divide and conquer. Divide and conquer. And they've done it. We have to set about being very, very focused, very, very truthful, very, very brave, and standing up to this and explaining to people and deprogramming them and reaching out to them and understanding what's happening. But we also have to route the source of it. The Democratic Party, the Republican Party leadership, the MSM, what's left of it, because they're gone. They're going to try to reorganize right now, and you can see they're all shell-shocked, but their only instinct is to double down with the race baiting and to say this election was a white lash. When record numbers, I have them right here, it's in the Associated Press, they even admit it, of blacks and Hispanics voted for Trump. Record numbers. People are leaving the Democratic Party plantation, they're leaving the Republican Party plantation, and Trump needs to deliver now with tax cuts and to hold spending where it is, and to actually have real projects in this country to create jobs and to create innovation and to get people to positively again think about building up society and having optimism, which can very easily be done. We can fire this engine up in just a few months. Here's the problem. And here's my advice to Donald Trump. I'm going to shoot some special reports on this I'm going to be talking to him probably today. He was saying to him, He's smart, he knows this, but here's the bottom line. They're going to try to implode the economy before he even physically gets in middle of January. They're going to work as hard as they can. And I said this Tuesday night, Wednesday morning, Drudge linked to it. We put the video on screen. I think the headline from memory is globalist, it's the exact headline. Globalist plan to destroy economy to bring down Trump. And then obviously blaming on him when it's their whole system. He hasn't even gotten involved yet. They did plunge the market, but now because of individuals getting involved and people having more exuberance over it, there's going to be tax cuts. It's gone way back up, 300, 400 points. Just that's epic. So the good news is there's a fight going on, and it's between people that understand what's going on and folks that are not aware of what's happening. And then there's that little group in between that's trying to manipulate both sides against each other when prosperity for everybody is what's going to make this country and this world have a future. And you read the WikiLeaks, it's all about picking winners and losers and keeping people poor so you can dominate them and control them and use them like chattel. It is the most selfish, satanic, evil crap I've ever seen. And Christ said, it'd be better for you to kill yourself than to hurt these children. And if you elaborate on that, it means childlike minds. I mean, who would go rob, say, a Down syndrome, say, 10-year-old walking down the street. You know, we hear about that, it's worse. Like we hear that, you know, some people mugged a 30-year-old man, it's still bad, but he's a man. But, if, you know, if you mug a retarded kid, see, political correctness, mugging a kid's okay, just don't say retarded. No, I'm going to use the words I want. Nothing against retarded children, that's the word, retarded, held back. See, it's a war on words. And then next, mentally disabled isn't, disabled isn't the right word. See, it's all about them controlling language. Retarded child. Mugging them is terrible because we know they're even more disadvantaged. It's an even more cowardly move. We have an instinct to protect and build up the least of us, and they're removing that from us. Oh, let's kill the retarded child. That's what the big liberals are calling for. Let's kill grandma. But we love grandma, and we represent grandma, but kill her and hire 10 teachers, Bill Gates said. Who robs a pregnant woman? Thief snatches necklace off Florida woman's neck just hours before she gave birth. See, people get outraged by that. So I have all these videos I'm going to play in a moment of the latest knockout games and people being attacked, people being beat up. Imagine the image of, say, a bunch of Caucasian men beating up a Hispanic woman. People would be outraged. It happens with people waving Mexican flags. Nobody cares to a white woman. The hundreds of videos out every few months of black people beating whites, sometimes to death. And it's just all a big joke. It's because they inherently deserve it. Some poor white guy. And then they're beating him up, an old guy. It's just a total joke. But I'll tell you this right now. And they're in his car robbing him while all this is going on. The answer to this is carrying a firearm. And the beating just goes on and on and on and on and on and on. And it's totally racial. It's just like five guys in KKK robes beating up some old black guy. Remember the old black guy that got drugged to death in East Texas? It was the biggest national story for several years. And what was crazy was is that he'd been a prison guy himself, and they'd been in the prisons, been in prison wars with each other. The KKK and then the black race group he was in. And they drug him to death. And it was wrong. It was terrible. Then three black males about a year later in the same town saw an old drunk white bum and drug him to death. Now, here's the difference. They hadn't been in a gang war with each other. This was a completely innocent, drunk white bum doing nothing to black people, and they killed him. Now, listen, both things are evil. No one covered it but the local newspaper. That's how controlled the media is in this country, is that it's so controlled that all these racial attacks happening to where now, I guess I cannot safely, especially with my children, in this climate, I have to, for safety, like it's a prison, you've succeeded, MSNBC. I'm going to more and more have to segregate and from areas where, because I'm white, I'm going to be attacked. I mean, it's definite. It's going on. And it's intensifying. And this is what the so-called liberals have done to us? This is what liberals do? No, this is what George Soros does, stirring up the different Islamic groups to bring down their countries, funding the Arab Spring, and the media promoting it like it was a good thing. And what they did in Ukraine, and what they do everywhere else, they go and find the different racial or religious divisions, and they turn them against each other. In the Ukraine, it's Catholic against Orthodox. It's Russian against Ukrainian. In eastern Ukraine, what's it mean? Doesn't Ukraine just mean border? Eastern Ukraine's always been part of Russia. It's just total mental illness, folks. But they go in there, and they create this division, and they play it off, and people go along with it. And do you know how? I'm going to skip this break. Do you know how George Soros overthrew Ukraine 2.5 years ago? He brags. He got $5 billion of our tax money. He matched it $2 billion, $7 billion. And they went out, and they had TV stations they bought, air stuff constantly showing bad cops shooting people and beating people. Then they said the whole government did this, used a few case points, and then started shooting police and then burning things, and then they called it a civil war, and then our media got behind it, and then the CIA got behind it, and they overthrew Ukraine. Now, you see what they're doing here now. This is an attempt to overthrow the country, and it got so desperate that even our own corrupt agencies said, they're really going to overthrow the whole thing and bankrupt everything and really have a race war? You know what? We already know they're doing all this pedophile stuff and stealing and everything. We've got the files. Go ahead and release them. This is too much. Finally, some sanity. And if Hillary wouldn't have conceded because they were already trying to steal the election, and they did steal some states, you know what's ready to come out. And I told you months before it was pedophilia, and I told you months before it was devil worship. I told you, they attacked me. Oh, Alex says we're devil worshipers. He's crazy. Ha, ha, ha. There's nothing on these WikiLeaks. Oh, and they're Satanists. Of course they're Satanists. Have you read the other stuff? I can't wait to make them poor, keep them in the dark and hopeless. Aye, we all agree submerging them into despair is the way to do it. And totally bankrupting them, these pathetic scum. I mean, who sits around like writing emails? I filthy American people. I hate these black people and Mexicans. So sick of them asking for stuff. It's just like, what the hell? Then they go on TV and go, thank God they're all so stupid. And then you got Charlie Rose with all the White House writers. Yeah, we wrote stuff about how they'd be able to keep their doctor. That was a really funny one. They're so disconnected, they're celebrating how they're effing everybody over on TV because they live in all the big compact cities with the desperate, dumbed down, poor people. Whether they're white or black, you look at them, they look like their souls have been sucked out, just shuffling around. So they pull up in their $200,000 Mercedes and go into their multi-million dollar flats, and they sit there and like shove the maid aside and hop around and laugh, and they look out the window, all the poor, desperate people that watch TV all day and have had their souls sucked and been taught they're ugly and poor and bad because they're not on lifestyles of the rich and famous. Madison Avenue has warped their brains. Their psychological warfare manual's on this. They've taken their families away. They've taken their honor away. They've taken away who they were. They've given them poison food. Well, they don't even know who they are. And all these little demonic skeksy vultures are perched on top of them, looking down on them. And then Obama realizes there's still a spirit in the country of people that have guns and grow things and you know, aren't under our full control yet. What do? We call them white people. And we make it all racial. So if they ever don't want to go along with something, they're racist. And then we tell all our slaves in the inner cities, you don't have a good life because there's white people in Montana. You know why they won? White people did it. And the KKK is taking over. And then you wonder why. You get out of a gas station, you wander in, and it's almost a war scene. And you're thinking, am I being paranoid? Is that guy looking at me like he wants to attack me? And then that guy checks out, and the guy behind the counter, Hispanic guy, goes, yeah, Alex is pretty scary. People are pretty mad. Well, what do you think? And I said, well, Trump's going to cut taxes for poor people. He goes, I know, I like it. He goes, well, it's scary. I walk outside. Big black guy comes walking over. Starts looking at me like he's thinking about saying something. And I just go, okay. But, I mean, we are so far gone, ladies and gentlemen. We are so far gone. They have literally set up abortuaries in all these neighborhoods. They have literally destroyed these people's families, shipped drugs and done it all. Now, as an organized army of dumbed down zombies, they're going to forge these giant unwashed masses into the final detonator to sink the country. Think about that, and we will be just like Venezuela, folks. So you want to go under hardcore social engineering, you're looking at it. And so understand, when you see MSNBC and CNN, these are sworn enemies of you and your family. This is a war. I mean, think of it as a naval battle or a space battle. Imagine InfoWars is like Defense Ship 1 or Defense Ship 5, doesn't matter, but like out there blasting with the truth in a war with their own documents, and they're just mining the waters with racism, sexism, homophobe, infight, divide and conquer. That's all they've got. And again, they teach themselves, they brag how to lie, how to deceive, how to F you over. That's why you read these emails, it's so nasty. You say, how are these people all so evil? It's not that that's so common. It's that you don't get in their club unless you sit around talking about how much you hate the general public. You understand that? I had some other guests. I've pretty much canceled them. I've got Rappaport coming on because I want to just take time to play clips and cover the news. But we're in incredibly positive straits. They tried to steal everything. And here's the positive news. They were going to get 4 to 5 Supreme Court justices. This is a reprieve on the execution of the country. They were already had fully dissolved the borders and were trying to collapse the economy by letting everybody with diseases come in at record levels, not even treating them, which is a serious crime on multiple levels. They were going to launch a war with Russia, and they still might try it in the next 2 months. They were going to do a hellish thing. I mean, we had true evil scurrying around, couldn't believe it was in full control of the New Atlantis, couldn't believe it was in, had actually seized the mythical republic. They actually have it in their hands partway, and we're about to finish it. And along comes Donald Trump and InfoWars and Drudge and these movements that were already there and Americana waiting for its spirit to come right back in. And now the Phoenix is beginning to fire up. It is not risen again, but the fire has been, and the enemy is screaming in fear, like a volcano is going off. They see the fire in the night. Because what happens once prosperity flows and honor and strength, and we rediscover who we are and we come together, and all these people manipulating us against each other have been exposed for who they are? Their control is over. See, you don't want control. You're a patriot. You just want your own life. You build things. They want control. Before I go any further, because they're going to kill me, because I never plug, I want to thank everybody for your support. We have extended it. They'd actually taken it down this morning. I said, no, this is a victory. This is a celebration. I'm extending it right through this weekend, but then we have to stop. 34% off all the storable food, 30% off Supermel Vitality, 30% off X2, DNA Force, 30% off. Everything is 30 to 40% off, except for the apparel. That's 15% off. Trump is my president shirt is about to sell out, and it's limited edition. That will be gone. Infowarsstore.com is the umbrella site. Infowarslife.com is the subsite. Madein1776.com is the Made in America apparel subsite. But you can find it all at Infowarsstore.com. Free shipping, free shipping, free shipping. And by the way, we are ready into the next phase of the war, proving we deliver, proving we are totally committed, and the zeitgeist of resistance, that we are now ready. Take this like a military operation. We've got one battered attack cruiser, folks. All right? And we have sunk more enemy ships than probably anybody out there in this fight, okay? And we want to launch more ships. I don't want the responsibility, but I don't know. Maybe we need 10 ships. Maybe we need to be bigger than Fox News, 5 times bigger, 10 times bigger. That's up to you. I mean bigger. I mean having the personnel, having 1,000 people, not 60. If we have 60 people, imagine what 100 would do, 200, 300. I don't want to actually do that because of infiltration and other issues, but we want to hire 10, 15 more people. And if you fill our coffers, you better believe I'm going to reload and launch another frigate and retool this one for the next attack profile. Stay with us. We are victory. We are 1776. We are America. Well, you want to celebrate? I've had some sleep. I'm ready to celebrate. I love this country so much because I know what it represents, and I know why the enemy hates it so much, that when I see it barely saved, but still in deep, deep trouble, it upsets me. But seeing like an animal that's down and that people are making fun of it, that gets to me. And I talk about Russia, and I think about how our globalists that control us literally put the Russian Revolution in place and did all of that. And I've had top historians on, and they could totally concur. That's a fact. And then you think Russia has thrown off the very same globalist, and it's certainly not perfect, but is trying to reorganize. And imagine if Trump is able to not have the globalist keep this whole war with Russia going, and if the United States allied with Russia under free market terms and business and all the rest of it. China is the true evil and is so satanic. When I say satanic, I mean mobile execution vans, 80-plus million dead under Mao. Our elite put those communists in there. We could support independence movements in China and actually reform China and have better trade deals with China and have better free trade deals and fair trade deals to give a living wage to the Chinese to rise humanity, not have a giant sucking sound. Ross Perot explained this to everybody, okay? When you pay more, then your employees can buy more products and you build a better civilization. Humans can build whatever level of comfort we want. The problem is it creates decadence. That's a byproduct and a problem. But he explained it. And we ought to find those clips from those presidential debates, but also when he was on Larry King with Al Gore. this is a good deal, Larry. And then he's like, okay, stop interrupting me. I'm explaining this one more time. Before we did this latest trade deal 2 years ago, this was 2 years ago, with Canada, they were getting paid $35 to $40 an hour on average. Now, our auto workers, $25 an hour. Now, within a year of that happening, they've already dropped down to $25, and we've dropped down about $5. Mexico's paid less than about a dollar an hour manufacturing. Let's say they go up to $3. And I'm paraphrasing, but this is basically what he said word for word. We're going to go down to like $10, and they're going to go down to about $3. This is a giant sucking sound. Then, once that's happened, that'll move to China, or that'll move somewhere else where it's even less. You cannot lower the wages and then open up to this trade and not destroy the economy. Now, was Ross Perot right or was Ross Perot wrong? And who supported Ross Perot? Donald Trump, who paid millions of dollars to put op-eds in the New York Times, the Washington Post, and hundreds of other papers written by Trump saying, don't do this. Don't do this. This is a bad deal. And look what happened. That's why they hate Trump, folks. He'll do deals with China. He doesn't want them to totally collapse. That will make us collapse. But it's going to be equitable deals where we raise the economy. He wants to put some golf courses in over there. I mean, we can have whatever economy we want, folks, but we have to decide that we're going to demand on a quality system. By the way, CJ pointed this out because I'm not good at pitching stuff. He's absolutely right, and I'm never plugging. We're running deals right now where you can get BrainForce for like $11, and there's free shipping. And he's right. At that level, it's a loss leader. So if you want to support the broadcast, when we have deals that are this big, please buy some of the other products. I mean, DNA Force, 30% off, 34% off, a bunch of other items. Everything in the store is massively marked down with free shipping and 10% off when you sign up for auto ship on things that are obviously things that you reorder. You order a crank-powered solar panel shortwave radio, you'll probably never need another one in 20 years. But something like Survival Shield X2 or DNA Force or Super Male Vitality, you need that every month or every 2 months, 6 months, you can sign up for auto ship. Additional 10% off. And a lot of stuff is a loss leader. It means we lose money for new listeners that might be public school educated on a lot of these products. So absolutely check them out. And I want to thank everybody for their support. InfoWarsStore.com. Big news straight ahead and your phone calls. The entire political map has been rewritten, not just here, but worldwide. Mainstream media is totally discredited and in freefall collapse. The Democratic Party and the Republican snot-nosed establishment are in total crisis mode and realize that none of their BS is working, and they were just hit with a giant tsunami repudiating their globalist, crony capitalist, anti-free market, fascist dirtbag system. They've been hit by Brexit. They've been hit by Russia pulling out, leading the pack. They have been hit by other independence movements all over the world, anti-globalism movements in Brazil, in Spain, in Portugal, in Greece, in Italy. We're all this close, folks. And they said in the Washington Post, I hammered all this, and the Financial Times, The Economist, world governments in crisis. If Hillary falls, she's the final domino. Just like in V for Vendetta when he hits that final domino and the inspector says, it was like it was all connected. It was. And only after you've been doing this so long and you see these things come to fruition and you witness these sea changes, do you know that there is a hand involved, an invisible hand. The globalists think it's their little hand. No, there's a much bigger hand. Look at the story here on Drudge. The new world order. And it goes in the New York Times. Trump's victory promises to upend the international order, which is George Soros and a handful of other scumbags, tax exempt, above the law, screwing everyone over. And what's stunning is that the New York Times and everybody else thought they could just keep telling us, it's ridiculous. There's no way Trump will win. And I'm sitting here, I'll just tell you, involved in internal, real scientific polls. And for these polling agencies to even do them, you've got to agree to never even publish your results. They won't give you a real poll unless you say you won't publish it. Oh, I'm serious, because then that's called internal polling. And then we checked other polls, but I talked to other people. And I've paid for public polls before, and they had all the newspapers, New York Times, Washington Post, Austin Marriage Statesman going, Alex quaintly again claimed he has access to internal polls and said Trump's 10 to 15 points ahead in the red states, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 points in swing states, and may even take some blue states. And did he take some blue states? Did he take almost all the swing states? Did he win just like I told you? Did I just, Hillary and Obama are devil worshippers. Oh, it comes out. Oh, Trump's going to win. I had Bev Harris on yesterday, and I laid out my analysis. She said, yeah, that's basically spot on. And I'm not bragging. It's just that I don't watch football and baseball and stand around with my buddies talking about the engine in my car all day long. I live this stuff. I know what I'm talking about. And it's such a repudiation of these snot noses that they sit around like followers together, all chirping like a bunch of birds in a tree, that they have the answers, like parrots repeating the same 4 or 5 lines over and over again and then laughing at us. So they've collapsed. They're a joke. But the empire will try to reconstitute and strike back. You better believe it. The difference is, and the biggest game changer is this, and I don't have time today because I want to take your calls and get into news to explain what happened, but it's a microcosm of our victory, so I'll get into it now. And stuff I figured out about 10 years ago has since actually come out. You know, that's what's crazy. You figure something out, then later it comes out exactly like you saw. They're so smart, but once we know their game, it's over. They were worried about a states' rights movement 25 years ago, a legitimate states' rights movement of guys in suits and ties running for office, taking our country back. So they went and they financed FBI, Southern Poverty Law Center, ADL operatives, and others to go out with money and to go into the poorest areas and to basically create anti-government militias, which are constitutional. You can always tell which militias are run by feds or double agents because they'll say, Jones is saying we're feds. He's a fed. No. The militia's constitutional. It's good. All able-bodied men are part of it. It's wonderful. There are a lot of great militias out there. The Fed will go, he said all the militias are racist and work for the Fed. And that guy's probably speaks with a British accent. But then he goes off and, hey, don't listen to him. I'm telling you. I've actually seen people before switch into a whole other accent. They're like, let's get out, go here. Later, give the command team to the main base. I mean, you know, it's total psyop to try to stir up the liberty movement and brand the states' rights movement as a bunch of KKK, crazy, racist people, you know, brewing methamphetamine in their backyard. So they could then roll up all the other militias and plant pipe bombs on their property and send people to prison. This is what they do. So it's just like they branded that as racist because they were worried about it. They went and branded the Tea Party. It was started by Ron Paul and the Liberty Movement that the Republicans tried to take over as racist so the Hispanics, blacks, others would not feel like they could be libertarians. You see, they just get rid of the whole section, kind of like going to the mall and they say, sorry, there's no men's clothing here or there's no women's clothing here. You know, it's like, what? It's only unisex. It's the same thing of not letting you have the opportunity. Like, you're not allowed to go to a Republican event. You can't be a libertarian because they're all racist at that. But then people start actually going to those events and finding out it's the opposite. And the paradigm starts shattering. So they go into panic mode to try to keep it in place and make it all be race-based 10 times worse than it was. And it backfires in record numbers of Hispanic Americans and black Americans voting for Trump, seeing through it. But those that are susceptible to the programming, when they even turn it up more to try to keep them on the plantation, they get more violent. You understand? And so then that creates a perception that there's this bigger racist backlash against white people going on, which is meant to create the perception of whites actually getting into character and acting racist. It's social engineering, and they think we're dumb. They're stirring us up against each other. It's stupid, and we shouldn't do it, and we shouldn't be part of it. But that doesn't mean then we virtue signal and then adopt all the nomenclature of the left. We don't adopt any of that. But we destroy them with the truth and prosperity by going, we're not going to have reparations of people. Almost no whites in America had any ancestors that owned slaves. Most people immigrated here after slavery even ended. And even then it was 2% of the families that had slaves. What do you mean reparations? But we agree there's been economic degradation and segregation and problems that did economically suppress people. So Trump wants special tax incentives and tax cuts for black people. And conservatives were like, yay! Could you ever get the left to get something through? But they wouldn't do that because they don't want you to have your own money. They want strings attached to it. You know, I'm going to go to these clips. I'm going to cover the news. But let's play the clip here of sorry, dumbed down people. People have to die. Anti-Trump protester calls for violence on CNN. Let's play this clip. And by the way, this is just the stuff being caught on video. And there are scores of these videos coming out every hour. As the media says, oh, good, look at the good people out protesting, never calling it racial assault, never calling it attacks. People have to die. Anti-Trump protester calls for violence on CNN. And, boy, does this woman look like she's done any killing? She look like she can do any killing? I love how it's always the softest, dumbest people that are the ones talking about violence. Cupcake. If the globalists are ever successful and really kick off a full-scale civil war, let me explain something to you and your controllers like George Soros very slowly. I told you you were going to lose this election. I told you a tsunami would block even your election fraud. I told you they were going to release pedophilia on your bosses and devil worship. It did get released. Now, you have to understand something. Next phase, if you're dumb enough to actually start a big bloody civil war in this country, it's not going to go the way you thought it was, guaranteed. And last time I checked, sweetheart, looking at the folks out there on the streets, I don't care if they're black, white, Hispanic, they are the dumbest looking, soulless looking, softest, punkish morons I've ever seen. You folks couldn't lead a insurrection robbing a Walmart. I mean, what are Black Friday mobs going to do, huh? Give me a break. You're dumbasses, and your jokes, and you're following people that have oppressed you and used you, but even though you've been through all the psychological brainwashing, you sit here in the lap of luxury, eating so much food, it's killing you. And look, I've been fat too, I'm not criticizing anybody that's fat, but just look at almost everyone running around bitching. They're young, they're stupid, they weigh twice as much as they should, they're living in la-la land. This country's not free, you're just giant and fat, you got so much food. I mean, there are people starving all over the world. It's a joke. So let's play this lady. Here it is.
Lily, your sign tonight says...
Our lives begin to end the day. We become silent about the things that matter. If we don't fight, who's going to fight for us? People had to die for freedom where we're at today. We can't just do rallies. We have to fight back. There will be casualties on both sides. There will be, because people have to die to make a change in this world. But Trump, enough with your racism. Stop splitting families. Don't split my family.
And you're fearful that you're going to lose friends and relatives?
Let me address this. I go down to Cancun once a year or so because it's a two-hour flight from Austin. It's direct. Go down there, get some sun, whatever. I mean, they give you a visa tag, and one time I lost it, and they literally almost arrested me, flipped out, went through everybody's stuff and said, why don't you have the tag? You got to be out the day we say. And I said, this is the day. They're like, you said 5 days. This is the sixth day. And I went, I filled it out wrong because they had, you know, my dad's was with us. I mean, our family separators. I mean, every other country, you got to come in legal. You got to go out legal. And Trump's actually going to create a system where you can just, if you don't have a bunch of felonies, you just come right back in. Give me a break. Our borders are wide open, dummy. But you just sit there, it's crazy. The toll-free number to join us on this live Thursday global broadcast is 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231. Coming up, we're going to be taking your calls, and I'm going to get to a bunch of the clips I haven't covered yet. Obviously, we've got Trump going to meet with Obama at the White House, then going to meet with Republicans as well. Hillary says that We should let there be a peaceful transference of power yesterday, but I told everybody, Soros is only going to double down with the destabilization, and they have. So that's all coming up. We have shocking footage of black racist KKK equivalents just beating up innocent white people because they just said, you're white, you're a Trump supporter. This is happening all over the country. For every time it's caught on video, I'd say it's happening 300, 400 times. I mean, the reports from all over Austin I'm hearing, it's bad. Folks will approach white people and say, are you with Trump? And then the anger gets so bad that you start beating them or mugging them or attacking them. And this is all being led by university professor operatives and people in classic social engineering. It is very, 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 very sad. And they're all getting their degrees in this. You know, used to people wouldn't join the military if they wanted to go fight. Now women kind of join the social justice warrior corps. And they go out and agitate, and then cops get killed, innocent people get beat up. And it's causing thousands of black people to get killed in Chicago additionally a year just because now the police are slow rolling and not going into the areas. But this is true racism. This is the true face of evil. I mean, I would be just as disgusted if this was 5-6 white guys beating up a black person. In fact, I'd be more disgusted because I'd be ashamed of myself, even though I'm not associated with it. I this is very shameful. Now, talk about race-based politics, okay? The Republicans are the ones that ended it. They weren't perfect, but that's the party of Lincoln. And it was the Christians that pushed for all that. And then people like my grandfather that ran for county government and won after World War II, the first Republican in that side of the family in ever. Family didn't ostracize him, but they were mad at him. But the point was they ended up taking the county over with Republicans, and they did the desegregation, and they cut the taxes. And let's just say this, quite frankly, growing up, there'd be a lot of black folks on Christmas and other dates bringing us pies and watermelons and stuff like that, because they loved my grandfather so much because they knew some of the stuff went on behind the scenes. But he was a tough guy, my dad's dad, so it didn't matter. But it's just particularly weird to be attacked when the KKK actually attacked my family, and it can make a whole movie out of it. I'm not going to get into it. It's just too rich. I'll just leave it to you like that. Now, we see this whole KKK movement going on with the Hispanics. Most Hispanics aren't buying into it, and I'm not saying that in a patronizing way. It's true. Demographically, it's just not happening. Doesn't matter. It's a few percentage points that pushes over the edge. So Buckley had the idea to overlay Google Maps of the counties that went red and that went blue, and then to overlay the only areas in the sea of red that went blue. Every sanctuary city went blue. This is the demographic warfare. Now imagine in Mexico or anywhere else, if America was saying, send our people down there by the millions and then vote to turn it over to our form of government, they would arrest you. This is sedition. So Buckley, I'm glad you found this. This is amazing. I'm gonna give this to Don Salazar or Paul Watson. They tend to do the immigration beat, but this is stunning. What made you think to do this?
Well, you know, I was watching the show and I was watching all the episodes of all the violence that has been caused across the nation. And we all know, of course, that this is all being funded by Soros and all the globalists that are trying to destabilize the country by influencing these poor people, influencing their minds and trying to bring the hatred up inside of them. You know, for instance, here in Austin, they blocked off one of the major bridges here, arteries. It took me over an hour and a half to get home. In fact, I just stopped at a coffee shop and just read magazines and drank coffee. But the point is that there were lines and lines of buses waiting just about six blocks away, they had brought these people and ready to spirit them away.
And they attacked police cars here, did a bunch of other stuff. They were bussed in. And again, I was about 3 miles from this. And literally had people bowing up to me and stuff because I was white. And I was just like, man, imagine you're like a little white guy or a woman. I mean,
exactly.
I mean, I don't want to listen. I got kids, folks. I don't want to hurt people, but I'm going into another mode now.
Exactly. I mean, the thing that this proves, though, is that this was not an organic uprising. It wasn't people that are sickened by some political circumstance, you know, and have a righteousness in hitting the streets. It's people that are bought and paid for.
Yeah, if people rioted in New York over the devil worship and the pedophile stuff, I'd be like, let's join them.
Exactly.
No. It's not we're going after the devil worshipers or people that actually did something or some child molester that got off. We're just randomly beating white people up.
Right. So as I was watching these videos and I saw all the usual suspects, I saw Mecha, La Raza, I saw the communists, I saw the same people that are always at the front of these groups leading them with the bandanas over their heads so they can't be identified. And I thought to myself, wait a minute, what is the driving force behind this? And really, I was listening to this guy who is a city councilman here in Austin on NPR yesterday, and he was talking about how he was so scared that Donald Trump was going to influence the cities that are right now allowing for all immigrants to just be here, period. What are they called?
That's right. It is a sanctuary. It is a sanctuary. UN. It is a UN immunization program worldwide to ignore the national government, have cities shell out to it. This is an admitted program. We'll be back. What we're seeing is 21st century warfare. We are seeing the attempted takedown of the number one most wealthy, powerful nation that has built an empire. You're seeing it be captured by multinational corporations using the oldest trick in the book, divide and conquer, to create a race class war in the country, and the horrible, evil universities spewing out people with worthless degrees. Huge hordes of idiot graduate students leading race mobs. And man, you talk about evil. You look at these white professors and these people that are stirring all this up. They know exactly what they're doing. Behind closed doors, to a man, I've talked to them, many of them. They know, they start laughing and they go, of course we're taking over. Of course it's a manipulation. And it's like, they think they're so smart, Buckley, because they know how to screw somebody. And I'm tired of them. What do you want to say to folks out there? Because we're going to go back over this map in a moment. We've added another graphic that we're going to show. But for radio listeners, describe what we're looking at here.
Well, basically, I spend a lot of my time up here at InfoWars looking at metrics of all different types, whether it's viewership or it's marketing or sales. And so I'm always looking at different numbers. And I was going through a lot of the different maps from the election today. Kind of reviewing different circumstances, and I saw this really dramatic map that just showed a sea of red that basically, yeah, that basically the vast majority of the area in the United States voted Republican and for Trump. And there you see it right there. Just, I don't know what the percentage is, but I would say that's probably 90% of the geographic landmass voted for Trump. Now, of course, we all know that people are concentrated in cities. And
I think your dead reckoning's right. I think that's right about 90%. In fact, I was seeing them say that last night. It's about 90% geographically. But then if you overlay the admitted sanctuary cities where they ignore the federal law and give the illegals all this free stuff, which then further bankrupts the city, but brings in more political control and then more federal dollars, if you look at it, it's every piece of blue in the sea of red is an admitted command base. And it's funny you brought this up because we were exposing Gen 21 a few years ago, and we got some of their internal maps where they were admitting they have all these triangles where they triangulate the blue with the red, and they have 5 and 10 and 20 year maps like the communists in China. It's crazy how they're going to bring people in to those and then expand like pieces on a board to then take over the states. And that's what I'm saying. It's military precision, folks. It's military dedication, military precision. And understand, I wouldn't care if we brought in 30, 40 million people from Latin America if they don't have criminal backgrounds and they're hardworking. That's, we need people. That's fine with me. The great, wonderful. But they bring in many of the unwashed, the politicos. They bring them in, they brainwash them, they piss them off, they turn them into communist and socialist and La Raza. And listen, you were born in Guatemala, you lived there till you were 8, you know, with your dad and mom and the rest of the family. And you grew up on the streets of Guatemala City. And I mean, I remember when you were a kid, you'd be staying with us, you know, like you dream in Spanish back then. I hear somebody talking in Spanish, wake up, you know, you in the bunk bed next to me. And you've been a DJ and before that a bartender and all the jobs. I mean, you've experienced, because you speak fluent Spanish, the type of racist stuff. It's not most people who speak Spanish, but it's a good percentage. They're just like everybody else. There's racists out there. But there's this attitude, and they're always shocked when you know, come back at them with Spanish. But this is just the reality that this is going on. This isn't about Spanish-speaking people conquering America. It's about coming in and being run by the Ford Foundation and by globalists like George Soros and being used to kill a birthright that if you become a citizen of lower taxes and guns and freedom and what made America great. And if you look at Hispanic culture on average, it's one of the most compatible systems of what the real culture is with Americana. In fact, you see Hispanics love Americana. In fact, everybody else is abandoning it. It seems to be Hispanics that are embracing it. So it's this juxtaposed of Hispanics that aren't in these brainwashing camps and ever go out and have a job and live or successful and love it, but the New World Order is totally betting on you to win and bring down the country. I'm asking, how do we bet on you to save it and be the future that you are? It's your country. It's going to be 70% Hispanic in like 30 years. It's yours. Are you going to let them con you out of stealing it and blowing it up? I mean, this is crazy. So what do you want to say, Buckley?
Well, I think that's a great point, because there's this liberal ideology that they sort of own, you know, the minorities, i.e. the blacks or the Hispanics. But if you go into these you go into these you go into these neighborhoods, you'll see that Hispanics are primarily Catholic, they're primarily conservative, they're primarily really hardworking people who want low taxes and they want prosperity and they want to have a good environment for small businesses to thrive in. Now, if you think about the ideologies of the left versus the ideologies of the right, who do they align with, you know? But however, the liberals all think that just because these people are of a different colored skin, they're not white, that somehow they owe their allegiance to liberals. And that is just, to me, that's actually one of the most intense forms of racism. It's the,
and when just 40 years ago,
it's the tyranny of low
expectations. It was the Democrats saying, don't let Hispanics in the country.
Exactly.
Because, but then they flipped. They went, oh, Republicans, you're going to end all the race-based stuff? We're just going to flip and take that away from them.
Right. So,
by the way, we're better at race politics than you are.
Exactly. And so one of the things that has really been a stark contrast for me in this election is if you go and you look at all the communications and everything that Donald Trump said, he is always talking about the people. He's always talking about how we're going to bring the country up, fix the infrastructure, let mothers be able to stay home longer with their children. Lots of really compassionate, constructive stuff. And we go back and we dig through all those Podesta emails and all the emails in between Hillary and Huma Abedin. Not one email about them talking about how they're going to better the environment for the American public. All it was self-serving stuff. And so that boils down to me. To me, that boils down to the fact that they know that they have minorities hoodwinked. They know that they have them by the hook. And it's only this ideology, it's only this concept and this idea that they have so deeply ingrained into their society.
I agree. It's total entitlement. And the New York Times had this Trump's last stand, and they talk about memos they'd gotten and people they talk to. They're like, Trump's insecure. He's always asking people and working with people about how he can make minorities like him and what he can do for them. He's pathetic. This is like, oh, we have secret stuff. He really wants to figure out how to fix things. Meanwhile, you got Podesta emails and these dumb black people and I want to rip this person off. I'll see you at the devil worship meeting. We got plenty of blood and semen for you to drink.
Yeah, it's disgusting. And I think it just really illustrates the core of what their souls are like, you know, what their ambitions are. Their ambitions aren't for the betterment of society.
I just want prosperity, but then don't do it at my expense and tell me I'm inherently bad.
Exactly.
And this is nothing but dumbed down tribalism. So,
and the thing that's nauseating is that the media has been in lockstep with them on this. The media has just really amplified their message, their PR message.
Well, I've always said, and one of the next things we should do is we need to get a couple folks to understand what's going on, that speak fluent Spanish, and create a Spanish version radio and TV show every day to just churn this information out, because this is key in the battle and the next phase. Buckley, what do you want to say to folks in Spanish?
Bueno, perdona mi español porque se me está olvidando mucho, pero te lo juro que nosotros aquí at InfoWars estamos trabajando por ti. Estamos trabajando por la patria, por toda la gente allí que está sufriendo y que está trabajando duro. Y tal vez a veces es difícil entender, pero si continúas a ver aquí en InfoWars y escuchas a lo que tenemos que hacer, lo vas a entender, te lo juro.
Think about this. The globalists have pulled the doors, the screens off, everything, saying we can't even have doors on the country. Right. Everybody else has doors. And then Trump says, we're going to put doors back on. Oh, you're so mean to me. It's ridiculous. Meanwhile, we have organized, admitted battle plans to overthrow the country, merge us into Mexico and Canada, and get rid of everybody's sovereignty and exploit everyone. And then they're bringing in all these third world populations. Forget, we talk about Mexicans all day. It's now Chinese, the main group. They're bringing them in as a new permanent underclass to exploit.
Exactly.
And then you get the memos. They admit they're exploiting. They admit they want to drive down wages. They admit they want to get rid of the middle class. It's so diabolical that if people ever get how diabolical the Democrats and the Republican leadership are, they're over forever. Because, folks, they're true villains. And people say, well, why is that? Because sociopaths and psychopaths start recruiting other psychopaths in, and other control freaks and other mercenaries. So at a certain point, it's a flashpoint. If you're not in the meetings going, screw these people, I love lying to them, a bunch of trash, I'll see if the devil worship meaning good, I'll see you later. You know, you're like, whoa, this is like Twilight Zone, they're so evil. That's how history is. They're a very small group of people, black, white, you know, anybody who's a psychopath, a sociopath, a mercenary, a sadist, it's a lot of different groups, but they all fit together in kind of legions of doom. And so you either in history dominate and defeat them, or they run everything. There's no in between. These aren't people you coexist with, because they're never going to coexist. I mean, I finally saw another Hillary sticker last night. In fact, I think there's some video of it. And it was the first time I saw a Hillary sticker where they weren't in the fast lane. So blocking everybody. That normally that's, you know, who's doing it.
That's a pretty good analogy right there.
No, I'm serious. Always. If I see somebody in the fast lane, they're going slow. Although they're going to have a Democrat
sticker. They call themselves progressives.
Oh, they're going to have a coexist sticker.
That's the irony.
Exactly. So they're blocking my life. So I get up there and it says, you know, we need to stop war, peace on earth. And then love Trump's hate. Trump around the world, all the top analysts say he's the detente, he's the peacenik, Hillary's World War III. Yeah. But here they are with their Democrat and Hillary stickers, and they've got a peace on earth deal. Again, it isn't congruent with reality. It's not real.
Yeah, I honestly, you know, feel bad for these people that have to walk around all day with this cognitive dissonance in their head, you know, repeatedly telling themselves that whatever the mantra is, that the, you know, I'm good, I'm not racist, I'm good, whatever they have to do in their head to justify, you know.
Look, here's how we got rid of a lot of the henpecking, Bible thumping, you know, oppressive Pharisee style control freak Christianity that isn't real Christianity. Okay, so we've gotten rid of a lot of that Victorian stuff, and so, but it all passed on to political correctness. So these are the same as people screaming at you on the street, telling you you got to go to their church and you're with the devil because your wife's wearing high heels. You know, those are folks that drive people away from Christianity. Okay, it's the same thing. It's just like you're a racist. And it's just not even. You're like, get out of my way, man. What is your problem?
Which is the actual inverse of tolerance. And if you go out on social media and you see how all these you know, hilltards, I don't know what they're calling them these days, but all the people that are basically, you know, following Hillary over the cliff, you know, how vicious they are and how nasty they are. And that's it's the inversion of
Owen Schroyer found the most insane women ever where we can't show because it's almost all cussing. They are screaming like zombies in a movie, scrabbling at, you know, trying to get in or something. They're just like completely out of their minds. And it's like, he's doing nothing to them.
Right. Well, but that's what they're trained for. Is they're trained that if they're louder than you are, then they have the right to overpower you with their voice, even though what they're saying doesn't make any rational sense. And so, you know, to bring this all the way back to what we were talking about with the sanctuary cities and Soros, is that the globalists are trying their damnedest to get inside and destabilize this country from the inside, cause divisiveness, and try to get us fighting each other. Because if you look at it from the perspective, if you back way out, the globalists are 0.00001%. And all they do is they're on a really, really long lever. And all they can do is throw a whole bunch of money at people to get them angry and freaked out about an imaginary circumstance. And if we can break their conditioning, if we can break through the lies and break through.
Well, that's it, because it creates real uncomfortableness. Where, you know, people are getting attacked all over Austin. I mean, all the people are going, yeah, this person got attacked. Yeah, they got attacked yesterday. Yeah, yeah. People got attacked last night. I mean, now I've got to, like, watch where I pull in. This is what the evil media has done.
Exactly.
And now that's going to create real racism because not everybody is sophisticated like I am.
That's true. Well, here we are at InfoWars, and we don't, like you always say, we don't always get it 100% right. You know, we're just sort of looking at the tea leaves and digging through all the information. But at the very least, we're getting a big, wide swath of information and comparing historical contexts to what is happening right now. And I believe that right now in this election, I mean, we've quadrupled in size as far as our audience is concerned, as far as our reach is concerned. And we're winning this war.
And by the way, if all the new listeners just tell somebody else about it again, like the last wave did, and then another wave, we're going to have, I don't even want to say this on air, because right now with the election, let's not exaggerate, our last peak was about 30-something million people in a week, one way or another, tuning in. I can announce to folks that on current trends, by Sunday, I think conservatively we would have had 80 million people that we can actually register, and I register real IP addresses, real videos watched, ratings we can check with stations. I mean, right now we're sitting at 65 million conservatively.
Right, yeah.
65 million people.
Let me say this, because Alex is actually a really humble person. In real life, he's a really humble person. He gets on here and he screams and he shouts and he gets really intense because he's trying to get your attention. But one of the things that Alex has done is that he has taken almost 90% of the funds that we generate here at InfoWars and put them back into the system, into what we are building. And people, I've seen it 100 times, people who haven't been here in a year in our offices show up and go, oh my God, wow, this is huge. This is twice as big. This is amazing. Look what you guys are doing. And so that's what Alex has been doing for 20 years. Year over year, we've been growing almost exponentially. And the reason why is because he's not greedy. The reason why is because he believes in this in his heart, and he's putting all of the effort that he has, including all of the monetary resources that we get and build, back into InfoWars.
And let's expand on why. Why I use military terminology, because the globalist, it is military. This is a scientific attack, folks. Think of it as space aliens. It's not space aliens. But what I'm saying is the technocrats see themselves as a breakaway civilization. And they're doing things chemically, culturally, everything like they're better than us to play us off. And as long as we don't know the experiments going on, they're going to win. We're here to show the experiments happening. And I know this is a takeover. I get chills. I know they're predators, like a guy breaking in my house, man.
But here's the beautiful
part. I have the energy to like stop them. I'm nothing special. We're under attack, folks.
Here's the beautiful part is that we are not beholden to anybody. We're not beholden to anybody. We don't answer to George Soros. We don't answer to any huge corporations. We don't answer to our advertisers or anything. We can say what we believe here. And that's why what you get here is 99.9% of the truth. Sometimes we're wrong, but that 1% that we're wrong, it sure as hell doesn't compare to the 99%. Right, Alex?
Well, they're trying to lie on purpose. And speaking of that, we haven't plugged this whole hour. I want to hire 4 or 5 more writers, camera people, editors. And I think that's probably it growth-wise because it's just too much to handle. And that's what people need to take advantage of InfoWarsStore.com. We have 30-40% off across the board for the nutraceuticals, a bunch of other items, 50% off on the Molon Labe gun apparel. You've got free shipping on top of that. 34% off on swearable foods. You guys are taking it down this morning. I made the decision to put it back up. But then you made the point. Okay, BrainForce sold out. This is selling out. A bunch of items have sold out. Unless you're signed up for auto ship, then we keep some back in stock. But a lot of items are selling out right now. InfoWarsStore.com or call toll free 888-253-3139. And some of these are lost leaders. But you know what's great? Because you get the product. You love it. It works. You enjoy it. You're going to buy it again, which is symbiotic. You're funding this operation, getting products that help you, that are good for you and your family, that are useful, and then it funds something with piranha-like dedication that is going to attack the enemy.
And if you sign up for AutoShip, you get 10% off your products in perpetuity. And you get them. You don't have to order them every month. Every time that you run out of one, a new bottle shows up, and you have what you need.
That's right. And look, I'm not fighting this to lose. People keep thinking, you know, like, we're underdogs. No. We have the truth. They're the villains. We're promoting prosperity and freedom. We're going to win. I keep telling everybody, we're going to win. The churches taught that until 100 years ago. Now they've been taken over.
Absolutely. And we're in this for the...
Sometimes, though, the good guys win, especially when you're the United States of America.
The war is over.
Von Bismarck said, God loves children, drunks, and the United States of America.
Everybody knows.
And that has been marveled at for over 240 years by every empire and every enemy. Almost every time, incredible providence that's just unspeakable happens always when it appears the Republic is on its last legs. Because as ugly as this country's been, we're the prettiest thing on this planet. Go to other countries, folks, and experience the corruption of what it's like there and the classism and the spirit and the death that you feel in the culture. No matter how beautiful the people may be and how amazing their culture, there's something twisted there. There's an evil. We're trying to promote freedom worldwide. I'm going to start the next hour, and I'm going to go right to Andrew in the UK and Dave and David, and I think that's Monica or Monica, and then we got Justin and others. Getting old, man. My eyes are going out. I got to move that TV closer so I can actually see those calls. Before we go any further, there's a bunch of clips. I mean, I tell you, Matt does such a great job with the rest of the crew getting all these dozens of clips. We have Putin congratulating Trump. We've got White House doesn't rule out pardoning Hillary. That is so huge. MSNBC reporters, stock exchange chanting, lock her up. We've got mass celebrations erupt across Russia. Meanwhile, oh, it's not because they're racist. It's because they don't want World War III. And then meanwhile, we've got shock video. Again, black mob viciously beats white Trump supporter. Emotional Clinton supporter. Hillary needs to sue the U.S. This is just so pathetic. And then mainstream media now has picked up the line. Van Jones started it. A white lash. That's right. We want to make America great again. That means cut the taxes. We've been in a depression. The economy's been falling apart for a while. Most of the areas of the nation look like a bomb hit it. And that's what that means. It doesn't mean a white lash. Was it a big dominant group of white people that voted for Trump? Absolutely. With record numbers of blacks and Hispanics. So sad, so nasty, so evil, so just absolutely despicable. And I'm going to say this right now to the establishment. You're arrogant, scum like you, always become delusional, and you always fall. The problem is there's nuclear weapons now, so none of us can afford to let you get to the failure point. You have to be dealt with. And that's why you think the awakening's hardcore now, you've seen nothing. The military and the police knew I was telling them the truth because they were on the inside and knew that I was aware of real information. I reverse engineered it, decompartmentalized it, so did our guest. Then when you tried to launch a civil war the last 5 years to destabilize things, they completely broke with you and finally figured out it's do or die. They had to choose a side. Rediscovering Americana, rediscovering the Republic, it's happened. Not that our government's perfect, but it's not the globalist out to get everybody at, you know, spirit dinners, devil worshiping with Aleister Crowley, witches. I mean, you know, people get it. You're evil. They've seen the WikiLeaks. They know. Media that signed on to this, Hollywood, with more than 20 movies about blacks being killed and murdered by white people and KKK just to traumatize people they put out in the last year. That all failed. Billions spent churning out garbage. Everything you could throw at us and trying to steal and stealing several states. Beth Harris is a Democrat. She confirms a bunch of states, over 100% of the people were voting in precincts for Hillary. Always right at the end, late night. Stuffing ballot boxes. You failed miserably. Because you are of your father, the devil. You worship a loser. That's why you're so unhappy. It's why no amount of money or power ever makes you happy. So do the world a favor. Before you try to burn America down or try to push abortion or try to start World War III, I don't want you to die. I want you to repent and wake up, but a lot of you won't. So if you're so into death, kill yourselves. I'm serious. If death's so sexy and cool, you like to go to devil worship parties, just slit your wrists. We'll be back with the third hour. You know, Matt is just making the best points around here. I demand he and some of the crew to start a weekly show. He was saying, we got to do an end zone dance.
Alex Jones.
We got to do it.
From the front lines of the info war.
Because that's a psyop back on them. They always want to laugh at us, demoralize us, make us feel like losers, make us think that we can never stand up for anything that's right. They want to bully us. They want to get in our face and tell us we've got to roll over and that we're bad people. You're the losers. You're the liars. You're the ones that are failures. You're a joke. So that's a great point. I'm going to go to some phone calls here, and then we'll take calls as John Rappaport joins us as well. But Matt, look, I agree with you. I'd been up 20-something hours. I slept 3 hours. I wasn't depressed when I came in. I just said, get ready. They're going to try to deactivate, the border even more. They're going to try to plunge the stock market. They're going to try to burn down cities. They're going to try to, and they're doing that right now. And so we have more battles to fight. But you're right. This has been a gigantic victory. The fact that they won't get their Supreme Court justices, the fact that that he's going to cut taxes on people making $40,000 or less to zero is going to just be such a great thing for blue-collar areas. This is going to just absolutely bring so many people up in the middle class. This is an amazing time to be alive. This is very exciting. Jump in, Matt. He didn't know. He's talking during the break. He's making great points. Go ahead and comment on that.
One of the things that I understand that, you know, the phrase plan for the hope for the best, plan for the worst. You know, I was listening to a guy who's a screenwriter, and he basically said yesterday, you know, this election does prove one thing, that your hopes are just as valid as your fears. And I think that's a big deal, because you point out sometimes what could actually happen, some of these scenarios. And I think you do a very good job at identifying the way that some of these elite people think, because, you know, if they believe we're below them, why wouldn't they do that? Why wouldn't they think that way? You know? And
so we need to let them know we're above them. I totally agree.
There's some hope. So
no, you're right. We should talk about what we can build instead of just what they're going to do to us. It's just that they're these horrible, nasty things attacking us constantly. That's why I get too focused on them. You're absolutely right. We should talk more about how good things could be without George Soros and David Rockefeller running our lives.
Yeah, and that's the beauty of Trump, you know, is that it gives you the ability to take control of your own life back, you know?
And to feel good about the economy again. They don't want us to feel good. They don't want us to feel like we can... Don't you notice they tried to plunge the stock market, but all these other small people came into it and have now pushed it way back up? But regardless, we can't be held hostage by them.
Yeah, and it's hilarious when you bring up the stocks, you know, how well some people are doing. They were making moves yesterday morning, and, you know, unfortunately, the military defense stocks, you know, defense contractor stocks, those went up. Energy stocks, I think those rose yesterday morning as well. So, yeah, I've got a roommate who does invest, and he said yesterday was actually a very good day for him. So,
well, let me break this down. One of the danger areas with Trump is the fact that he does want a giant military. I'm not against us having a powerful military, but they have overrun our military. They've degraded it on purpose, the globalists have, and have put it in a derelict state. We need to make it smaller but reorganized and better for defense, not for conquest. And that's what Trump actually wants to do, and they have a lot of technological innovations through that and relaunch our space program. I mean, notice we've gotten rid of the space program. This is crazy.
Well, also reassessing the purpose of some of these missions like NATO. Like, that was a big point that Trump brought up, you know?
But we're going to make them pay for part of it. I mean, if you're going to keep it, we're not going to pay for 60% of NATO anymore.
Of course. And there should be coalitions amongst free nations, free countries. But
that's NATO shouldn't be its own thing, dictating to us.
Yeah, and, you know, there's some big deficiencies of NATO, you know, especially when looking at border states where Russia can strike. You know, that I was watching a general. He gave a press release, man, it was a couple months ago, and he was talking about how the Russians could basically attack a country, but NATO's response would have to be a liberation campaign, because they don't have the ability to move throughout borders, which makes NATO terribly inefficient.
That's right. We'll be right back. Author, researcher, investigative journalist John Rappaport of NoMoreFakeNews.com will be joining us here in about 5 minutes. I'm going to go to some of your calls right now. Andrew in the UK, Dave in Michigan, Dave in Nevada, Monica in Canada, Justin in Florida. We're going to everybody in this hour and more. Toll-free number to join us, 800-259-9231. The seismic defeat of the globalists here in the United States, coupled with Brexit, coupled with the Russians in the last decade pulling out of the New World Order, is the end of the current world government system. And by the way, I've been saying that for months. The New York Times today, linked up on drudgereport.com, admits just that. All the delusional insiders, all the delusional Grubers on TV saying how dumb we are, the emails by the hundreds of thousands, how much they hate us, how they want to make us poor. We have to continue to get the WikiLeaks and publish about them and go back through them and keep hammering and hammering and hammering this criminal class. Hillary must be prosecuted. Obama came out and said he may give her a pardon. He said that this morning. Here it is. Here you go.
Thanks, Josh. Donald Trump, during the campaign, pledged to jail Hillary Clinton if he was elected over the federal investigations that are underway. Some legal experts have said that President Obama could close off that opportunity if he pardons Hillary Clinton. Is that something that the president is considering doing?
Well, Jordan, as you know, the president has offered clemency to a substantial number of Americans who were previously serving time in federal prisons. And we didn't talk in advance about the president's plans to offer clemency to any of those individuals. And that's because we don't talk about the president's thinking, particularly with respect to any specific cases that may apply to, you know, pardons or commutations.
Thanks.
All right. Now, next, we have Vladimir Putin congratulating one of the first world leaders to do it yesterday at a state event for the victory. And he, of course, said last week, this will be a vote against globalism and for national sovereignty against elites that have hijacked the United States, similar to the elites that have hijacked Russia. Well, it's the exact same elites. So this is the world pulling away from the exploitive garbage that is Obamacare and all of it. And Trump has come out and said he's moving forward with meetings today with the Republicans to push to build the wall and to repeal Obamacare. So this is the big first test. And Trump as he's told you publicly and myself publicly and privately, I will not disappoint you. He is going to set his will and your will against them. And if he can do this, he'll be as great as George Washington or greater, if he's able to carry this out. Already the feat of the landslide against their fraud and the rest of it. Bev Harris confirmed they stole some states from Trump. Our victory is huge and is seismic and repudiates everything they're doing and everything they stand for. It also shows their arrogance. They really believed they were invincible, like every other elite has in history. And that's what's so dangerous, because now we have nuclear weapons. We can't have the mistakes that other people made, like a Hitler or a Mussolini or a, you know, somebody like Napoleon. It can't be done now. And they're so disconnected. They're so arrogant. Billions spent, Hollywood, everything they had thrown at the American people. World leaders lecturing us. Everyone telling us we couldn't. And they're now in stun. We'll talk to John Rappaport about the paradigm shift, the sea change that's here, and where he sees them going next. But they could set a nuke off and blame it on patriots. They could blow up a school and say we did it. These folks are arrogant. Hopefully they've been knocked down enough that they don't cause some chain reaction, because we know they want a civil war. And I told you, folks, they start that, we win even bigger. I don't want to go down that road. It's going to be messy and dangerous. But I told them they were going to lose this. I told you we had internal polls. I talked to so many polling agencies. I talked to other folks. I'm not going to, obviously, the Trump campaign did not want it out. That's why I kept saying, it's rigged, folks, it's rigged. They would go out and get 10, 15 polls. Big corporate top polls, but private polls. And because they won't even do them for you unless they do their methodology. You just do straight up polling to this, and he was way ahead. I told you that. So we're going to play this clip, then take a few calls and go to Rappaport, and then back to calls. But right now, here's Putin.
Уважаемые дамы и господа.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Несколько часов назад в Соединенных Штатах Америки завершились президентские выборы.
A few hours ago, presidential elections have finished in the United States of America.
Мы внимательно следили за этой кампанией.
We have been following this campaign with attention.
Хочу поздравить американский народ с завершением избирательного цикла.
And I'd like to congratulate the American people with the end of the electoral cycle.
А господина Дональда Трампа с победой на этих выборах.
And I'd also like to congratulate Mr. Donald Trump with his victory in these elections.
Мы слышали предвыборные заявления еще кандидата в президенты Соединенных Штатов.
We have heard his electoral slogans when he was still a candidate of the presidency.
Которые были направлены на восстановление отношений между Россией и Соединенными Штатами.
And he spoke about resuming and restoring relations between Russia and the United States.
Мы понимаем и отдаем себе отчет в том, что это будет непростой путь с учетом той деградации, в которой, к сожалению, находятся отношения между США и Россией.
We understand that the way to that would be difficult, taking into account the current state of degradation of relations between the US and Russia.
И это, как я уже многократно говорил, не наша вина, что российско-американские отношения находятся именно в таком состоянии.
And as I have repeatedly said, that is not our fault that the Russian-American relations are in that poor state.
Но Россия готова и хочет восстановления полноформатных отношений с Соединенными Штатами.
But Russia is ready and wants to restore the full-fledged relations with the United States.
Повторяю, исходим из того, что это будет непростой путь, но мы готовы пройти и свою часть.
I repeat, we understand that this will be a difficult way, but we are ready to play our part in it.
И сделать все, чтобы вернуть российско-американские отношения на устойчивую траекторию развития.
And do everything to return the Russian-American relations to the stable and sustainable development track.
All right. The full statement is up on Infowars.com. Trump did better than Romney among Hispanics and blacks. U.S. stocks jump along with bond yields after Trump shock. A peso falls. And we got all the clips of Obama saying he'd never be president, making jokes. Hillary, the mainstream media. This isn't some foil where, you know, he's really an operative and they tricked the globalists or they tricked us. This is 100% real, folks, and they are in panic. Will they back off and be more sane? Or will they go ahead with the economic system of trying to have a controlled economy and make everybody else poor? Because that's their admitted plan. And that's not popular with almost anybody. Well, how will they counterstrike? We're going to your calls, a few of them there. As I said, the John Rappaport, no more fake news.com, and then back to calls. Andrew in the UK, thanks for holding. You're on the air.
Hello.
Welcome.
Yeah, hi. I was just phoning because I've got a Twitter account, and I'm always on Twitter. And I've seen today the gentleman at the junction, the road junction, with his car getting beaten by the other gentleman. I use the word gentleman loosely on that. And I remember Charlotte and what went on in Charlotte. And I'm just now waiting to see the BLM be activated and for the real violence to start. And I'm getting quite angry. I'm sat here shaking. I wish I was in your country, my son.
Well, let me tell you, the problem is that they want to ignite civil unrest and then say that it's a race war. And it's just a lot of really dumb teenagers and thug types that are taught that it's cool to go beat up an old man. A lot of it isn't happening. This happened in Chicago because a lot of folks don't pack. A lot of it doesn't happen a lot of it in Texas because they know a lot of people are armed. It's very, very sad. It's the media manipulating people. To watch five or six teenagers beat up or young men beat up an old guy is sad. But according to MSNBC, he's white, so he deserves it. These are the folks. I mean, even Time Magazine actually said, and so did Newsweek, that rioting and attacking people is good. Remember that? They said it's time to attack white people. This is white people, of course, saying it. Not because they want to reform anything, because they want us all at each other's throats. It's very, very nasty.
Yeah, well, I hope it all plays out, and it plays out well, and you stop them, because the way I look at them is the way I looked at the IRA through the Troubles when I was in the military. They are a domestic terrorist organization now funded by George Soros and Rockefeller and all the other foundations, just throw money at them. You don't know where that money goes, but obviously they know where the money goes. And I think
well, that's an interesting point you make, that George Soros was also, he's involved in everything, basically. I don't know how is he able to travel freely when he's been caught funding every destabilization group under the sun.
He's got more money and more power than all of us put together, dude. He killed Ukraine. The top 5% of Ukrainians run the country, not the 95%. And yet you're picking on Russia. What the hell, mate? You don't do stuff like that, buddy. You don't poke a bear like Russia. Russia lost 20 million men in the Second World War. Do you honestly think that they're not going to be bothered about losing 20 million more to destroy your slot? Really?
Well, that's right, and we have George Soros banned from Russia, and they kicked out all his groups last year, and our media said that Russia was a tyranny for kicking out thousands of operatives, U.S. citizens and others, in there. I can't believe they were even letting Soros operate until last year. We shouldn't let him operate. This isn't free speech. He is a globalist criminal, a frickin' international terrorist, and I want Donald Trump to have his ass thrown in prison. I'm tired of him.
About 2 weeks ago, and it was, I think it was Port Russia or something like that, the first bit, and then it went to another bit, which was a Russian newspaper. It was a photo of a Russian newspaper, and then it had the English subtitles for what the thing
sure.
said. And basically, they put a $100 million reward, dead or alive bounty, on his head. If he's hiding in the U.S., he's in trouble. If he's hiding in Europe, he's in trouble. The only place he can go is the Middle East, and he'll be in trouble there.
That's right. Thank you for the call. I'm going to skip this break, and we're going to go to Rappaport for a moment and just start going back and forth with calls for the rest of the hour. With John Rappaport, nomorefakenews.com, co-hosting with us, riding shotgun. And now that he's moved and stuff, he's been moving the last few months, he's going to be co-hosting some and also hosting by himself some. He's invited here to host once a week for an hour if he'd like to. Does a great job. Nomorefakenews.com. Again, I'm Alex Jones, your host. We're going to go to David in Nevada and, again, Monica and Justin and Dave and others. But when you think about the repudiation of the entire global government, corporate, Anglo-American establishment, that's what they call themselves. When you look at the repudiation of it and people worldwide against it, it's very sickening to see how they're using race-based systems when they're called the Anglo-American establishment. I mean, you couldn't be working for the establishment more than when you work for La Raza or Mecha or the Ford Foundation or Black Lives Matter. I mean, these truly are the useful morons of the planet. Now, five people try to attack and kill me. I'm going to defend myself, and I'm too old. I'm not going to even try to act like John Wayne anymore, even though I'd probably do a pretty good job. Look, all those little thugs would be really easy. It's like a joke. But only problem would be breaking my hands, and I'm serious about that. It's the only problem. I'm pretty sure I don't want to hit people full power. That use my elbows because my hands are so broken up. But Second Amendment, folks. But I don't want to get in a pissing match with these idiots. I'd rather wake them up. John Rappaport, a seismic, historic, over the top. I mean, you always tend to really hit it from an interesting angle, a illuminating angle. What do you say?
You talked about solutions a few minutes ago, Alex, and I think that's where we're at. Because Trump has been listening, and his people have been listening. Roger Stone's been listening. What are the solutions now? Where do we go? Of course, Trump has his agenda and so forth. But, and I mentioned this on the show before, bringing back life to the inner cities in America. Of course, that means bringing jobs back home. But, you know, the other day I looked on a search engine and I found in Chicago, not just an urban farm, but a directory of urban farms. I saw at least 8 of these local operations that are all geared to growing fresh, nutritious food for people, by people who live there, and so on and so forth. That's a revolution right there. Let's put 100, 1,000, 5,000 of these urban farms in inner cities across America for a pittance. People themselves could form them as businesses and make money. If Trump is listening to this, here's a clue. You want to bring back inner cities? Of course, you offer people jobs, good jobs, and also programs like this that for a tiny amount of money can reverse life completely in these inner cities. So I think that the new administration in Washington, if they have a clue about anything, and they seem to, are going to be listening to people like us, because we've been looking at solutions all along. This is nothing new for us.
It's funny you say that. Putin 2 years ago launched a national program, but it's local run, with tax incentives and things to go all organic and become the number one world producer of organics in just 5 years. And in the main release, they said this is how humanity gets back to the soil. This activates our human roots. It's spiritual. We have to get away from TVs, even a few hours a week, and get out in the soil with other people and then actually eat the food we bring in. It's a chain reaction. And you know what? I'm busy, but I'm going to do it. I'm going to sponsor an East Austin farm. I'm going to sponsor that for the public. We don't have a lot of money, but and we're going to just put folks in the community in charge. And I think the communists will probably attack it. They attacked this little cat section where that's how evil they are. But you're absolutely right, John. This is the answer.
Solutions. And if you go ahead and do that, which I think is great, just point out to the people that very quickly they can make this into a profit-making business of their own. So they can eat fresh, nutritious food that they grow for nothing, and then they can sell the food. And all of a sudden, you've got free market coming back into the inner cities.
And it's the spirit of humans cultivating and producing life. It's spiritual. It isn't really written in books, but it's true. Like Jefferson said, the farmer has the spirit and the ethic and everything for the moral society. We have to go back to human activity.
And my feeling is, and I mentioned this to a couple of friends yesterday, if you're living in an inner city and all of a sudden it starts to blossom with, you know, one of these, several of these enterprises, growing food naturally, growing it outdoors, growing it in abandoned buildings, growing it in all kinds of places. Now, the people that live there are invested in that community in a way that they've never been before in their memory. Now they're feeding themselves and growing food and selling the food and making a profit. They're in business. And now their demand, the level of their demand to live in a safe community free of thugs and gangs and drugs and so forth, reaches a new peak level that it's never been at before. This is not just, I want the freedom to be able to go down to the AM, PM because that's the only store that's there. You know, no. We've got something to protect now that's real, that's feeding us and making us money on a true product. Now you're going to see life in those inner cities completely transformed.
That's right. You are so on target. I want to intersperse calls because it'll take us in great different directions, John Rappaport. But after we take some more calls, what are other areas you want to get into?
Well, I think we should continue to talk about solutions. What solutions can we feed this new movement that has developed using Trump in a way as a symbol, you know, whatever else you want to say.
A battering ram.
a battering ram. The movement is gigantic. It got its legs under it with Ron Paul. These are many of the same people. These are many of the same people who have been outside the system that are now starting to look back in and say, well, what can we do? What
and that's what I was explaining to folks when Paul didn't win. He won by building the movement. And then Trump, even if he lost, would have won. But now that we've won, we've got to deliver.
Exactly. So more answers, more solutions about, you know, what can revive this country. Of course, bringing back jobs.
And this is America. We can revive it. They've beaten us down with a spirit of infighting and wickedness. It's going to be easy if we just keep hard charging and all of us do little things. I'm going to go over. I'm going to look at sites. I'm going to do it. I'm going to sponsor some local churches or something, and I'm going to help put in a big farm over here.
Fantastic. Fantastic. Here's another one. Health freedom. I was there in the early 90s as an active person in this whole thing that exploded, that some people will still remember when they raided Jonathan Wright's clinic up in the state of Washington, who was, you know, giving people B vitamins. And then all of a sudden the FDA was coming out and talking about restricting people's access to nutritional supplements. So this was before email or any of that. And Congress had millions of letters that were more than they had ever received before on any other issue. Those people are still out there, and basically what they're saying is, we demand the right to have voluntary choice in how we take care of our own bodies, and with no interference from the outside, period. That's it. And, you know, they call it the natural health movement, or health freedom movement is really what it is. And a couple of states actually passed laws, and what those laws stated was, okay, look, if you are a practitioner of any kind, and you are treating a person for a condition with a natural remedy that is no more harmful than the medical remedy for that same condition, you're free to do whatever you want. You're free to do it. Well, that's a pretty good idea. That's a good starting point. If we begin to expand that again and say, look, Trump, whoever's listening, there are millions of people out there.
Well, by the way, I mean, Barron did get hurt a little bit by a vaccine. He's gotten better, reportedly, and I'm not supposed to even get into that. But the point is, that's why Trump was saying, hey, vaccines are bad, watch out, there's too many of them, because he's experienced it.
Yeah, he absolutely has. So here, coming in behind that, the right of every person, especially parents, to decide on what is health for their family. Whatever they want to do, that is their choice. If that became a spearheaded movement within Washington, within the Trump administration, you would have countless millions of people coming back.
Well, sure. Look at the WikiLeaks. They're all figuring out how to screw people over and keep folks from having any part of the pie. When if we get people in there trying to build the pie, they'll all be kings over fabulous wealth. I mean, this is a huge engine. They've been blocking it on purpose. We know that.
Exactly. There's more to say about this. I hear some music.
Yes, we're going to come back, take calls more into this, but we'll talk about how the empire is going to strike back. Now, callers, I'm going to get better now, and I promise to take your calls. Monique and Justin and David and David and VC, everybody, we're going to get to all your calls. I'm Alex Jones. Infowars.com is the tip of the spear in the fight against the New World Order, because it's the truth, folks. And once the public knows the paradigm that we're under globalism, it's over. And I can historically, economically, culturally, but most important, spiritually, see into possible futures. The AI seduction will be our greatest challenge, not succumbing to virtual realities that are supposedly unfathomable ecstasies, not giving up our supposed human bodies for what we believe is some silicon upgrade. But in truth, it's just death and the biggest con game the universe has ever seen. I want to talk to Rappaport some, if he'll do a little bit in the next hour with Yipsiardi with me, maybe 10, 15 minutes, if he can't understand, just on what he sees as big future threats. Because people are always, you're being so negative. We have to admit the threats to be able to turn it around and not succumb to them. But this is a big game changer. And we see the race-based politics. We see the sanctuary cities, the Democrats believing they can do this colonization program. We have to absolutely counter all of that and really bring true information, true ideas, true economy Because if we just let the globalists set up these systems and then keep people under their control, they are being designed to basically be the zombie army of the New World Order. And my sheet said that Gucciardi was doing the fourth hour. That's why I announced that. Owen Schroyer's doing the fourth hour, so he'll ride shotgun with us. He's always a firecracker. Love Owen, the great work he's doing. Before I go any further here, just briefly, we've launched the paid app. It's $4.95 a month, half price out of the gates. And we've been so busy with the 52-hour, we actually went 60 hours yesterday, 60-hour broadcast and everything else. It just launched 2 days ago, but there are some original videos uploaded on there and some live feeds they've done. But the crew's all getting a tutorial today at like 3 o'clock on how they can use it. It's really easy to do and start uploading their own special reports, live events, feeds, myself, on a daily basis. So that's one reason to do it. And then also there's discounts in there that you could save the amount of money on your first purchase on anything in the store. I mean, we put a lot of loss leaders in there. I mean, 50% off select items. I don't mean just some side item we're not selling. We'll take the hottest stuff we've got and sell it at that. So the only place to find bigger discounts than we've got running with this special that ends this weekend is the InfoWars app, infowars.com/app, or go to the Google Play Store or to the App Store. It's InfoWars Prime. You go to infowars.com/app, you can find the free version. You scroll down to find that, or there you can pay for the subscription one, because it is a subscription to tyranny, the prescription to stop it, because it pays for the bandwidth of this platform. This is going to be like YouTube, but our own platform that's high-tech, being updated, that hundreds of reporters and users that I plan to end up getting on here will be able to then put intel out. So we'll have reporters like Millie Weaver on the East Coast, or you know, other reporters, you know, let's say out in New Mexico, who are then able to, whenever they want to file a report from home or the street or during a rally or a plane crash or a baby's birth or gardening or whatever it is, I can just say, here, boom, you're a trusted reporter or contributor. You're part of InfoWars Prime. And it's got a lot of other, it's got alerts, so we can send you emergency alerts, but also update alerts, infowars.com/app. I want to thank you all for your support. And then briefly, we do have, as I said, free shipping store-wide through this weekend that is going to end. We've extended it. And 30 to 40% off of storable food, 30% off nutraceuticals, a bunch of 30% off water filtration. Biggest sale ever to this date with free shipping on top of it. 888-253-3139. And you're making it all possible. Just like Trump didn't take corporate money or globalist money and didn't take Hollywood money and they all put billions against him, he won. Well, InfoWars is winning, going directly to you. He broke all records of small donations. He's against NAFTA, GATT, the TPP, globalization. We're going to your calls in a moment, and I appreciate Monique holding. But Rappaport, what do you make of just everything they did, everything they threw at him failing because the people were behind him? They tried to steal some states. They did. He still won in a electoral college landslide. What do you think's going on in the globalist war rooms right now?
Oh, well, they're trying to figure out everything they can possibly do to stop him. I mean, they want to promote tremendous civil unrest in the country, no question about it. It wouldn't surprise me if we saw, quote, a national student strike in America, where they would somehow organize, you know, many, we're talking high schools, colleges, just to go out on strike.
Block roads, run around, and then have a fake group consciousness that they're fighting racism. Anybody that's a nationalist is now a racist. You're part of the white lash. So a giant demonization of white people.
Yeah, a giant demonization, and also a demonization of the country as a whole. It's like if you want to boil this thing down, it's like somebody walks up to one of the people in the protest and says, look, I can get you a job. It's a productive job. I know you're not working. I know you have no money. Do you want a job, a decent job? No, I don't want any of that. I don't want anything to do with that, or where it comes from, or the society that promotes it, or the infrastructure that allowed it to be created. I want to stand out here and destroy everything that I can. That's my mission, because that's love, baby. You know, I mean, it's complete insanity.
And by the way, that's what they do. I had this guy ask me yesterday, you like Trump? And I went, yeah, he wants to cut taxes $40,000 a year or less. And the guy went, oh. Yeah.
He started thinking about his own bank account, right?
Well, they don't get how hard it is to build this infrastructure. I love how soft these kids are. They're sitting there in the middle of this infrastructure that is falling apart. they'll be crying for mommy if it does. I love Black Lives Matter up in Dallas when the Black Lives Matter guy kills five cops and shoots other people, and they're running around screaming, police, help us, police, police.
Really? Really? I mean, I've never seen anything like it. Because here we have an opportunity. We started off by talking about solutions. Okay, we have an opportunity to plug in now because the alternative media, as it's called, is so much more powerful than it's ever been. It's dwarfing the traditional media or the major media, which are dying. I mean, they're just...
And now they're not in control. They don't get to hand it over as easy. They don't get to wage war against us as easy. They don't get their Supreme Court justices. They don't get... Wow!
What do they have left? They have nothing left except to whine and complain and try to be clever about it and so forth. You look at 2 days ago, I looked at the editorial pages of the New York Times. It was unbelievable. One writer after another, those smarmy little turtles talking about Trump and this and a present danger and the country is going to hell, you know, and all their little stuff. I mean, they had like six or seven editorial writers spewing out this nonsense.
And they only say like five different lines.
Yeah.
You're a racist, you're a bigot, you're a homophobe, you're dumb, you're uneducated, you're a dumb Midwestern white person, and they're almost all white people. It's this weird thing where someone screams, you can't have an opinion, you're an effing white male, and it's some mom's basement, zit-faced, I'm not against zits, the point is, it's the archetype lazy bum telling you this to your face.
What was it, 3 weeks ago, a report came out on the New York Times that in this quarter, the category, I think they called it profitable assets, sank 97% at the New York Times.
That's right. And last quarter, 97.5% loss in revenue.
And they're refinancing the financing of the red ink that they originally financed, and they're tapping.
And here's the deal. All that Kingpin Mexico money, I mean, the Mexican slush fund, you know, the Kingpin, wink, wink, owns them. The guy that gets Obama phone money, now there's no reason for him to even own it because it didn't pay off.
Exactly. So why should he even be there?
In fact, you said that before the election. You said if they lose, they're going to call all these executives in and say, you're all fired. We're cutting all these divisions. None of you were able to deliver.
Right. Look what's going to happen to the Clinton Foundation. All these people that gave money and expected favors to continue on into the future with Hillary Clinton as president. And now, all of a sudden, what favors are they going to get? They're not going to get any favors. Well, we donated $15 million to you turkeys, and where's the payoff? So now what I expect to be happening is some of these people that are very angry are going to start themselves leaking information, more information on the Clinton Foundation. Because this is a parallel State Department. I mean, instead of diplomatic give and take that supposedly is the earmark of the State Department, this is you give and then we let you take. You know, that's...
Sure, we're going to calls right now, but I got to ask you this question, and we'll continue on to the next hour. We're going to go to them now. The Clintons had to try to steal this because they're in a corner. What are they thinking now, though, as the whole world turns against them, A, and then B... People are saying, well, Trump needs to be nice so the stock market stays up. It needs to be conciliatory. But they're not ever going to back off. Justice has to be done. We're not vindictive. He has to fulfill the promise. There have to be indictments. There has to be a special prosecutor. This whole nest must go to prison.
Exactly. You can't suddenly say, I'm the great healer and we're going to build bridges. That would be a serious mistake on his part. He got here by claiming that he was going to drain the swamp. Well, they're right in the middle of the swamp. There they are, the most visible figures. You've got to continue to go after
giant them. Giant squid and flesh-eating octopuses. There's Bill and Hillary, the giant stinking monsters that have come out of the loins of George Soros. I mean, what would you do?
What I would do? Prosecute, file charges, arrest them, take them to court. Don't make a deal.
That's what Putin did with the oligarchs.
Bring out all the evidence. Let's see it all. Release the evidence. Open court. Prosecute. Don't give in. Don't budge an inch. Keep moving forward. Attack. Because justice is on your side. And it doesn't matter what major media say or this or that and the other thing, because enough evidence is going to come out so that whatever the New York Times or CBS or CNN has to say, they're going to end up with egg on their face just like they did.
That's right. And I'm going to tell Trump something, and he knows this. He's a good guy. He's a great guy. The patriots, the people in the government, the military that risked their lives, a lot of people got killed, trust you. But if you don't deliver, understand, right. Hillary's going to be the least of your problems.
That's right. If you don't deliver. So you got here by saying certain things, so you've got to deliver now. And you can't back off of the Clintons. And you can't say, well, so many people feel sorry for them now, and let's listen to the PSYOP advisors who say, well, the surveys show that people want you to leave them alone and let them slink off. No, 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 no. Leave them right there in the spotlight. Appoint a new attorney general that's not going to mess around.
That's right. Keep them in the spotlight, Trump, or all of it's going to be on us. We've got to go on offense because that's our defense.
Exactly. You keep them back on their heels with seven or eight different vectors at the same time. So they have to play defense. You've got to do this. You can't just think that everything is okay now, because the empire is already striking back and they intend to keep striking back. Okay, fine. That's the game. That's the war. All right, Bill, Hillary, you're in the spotlight, baby. Now we're going to take you to court. Now we're going to show everything that we know about you. The whole works.
And by the way, private citizens have been affected by this pay-to-play and breaking laws and bid rigging and stuff. So private citizens should look in the WikiLeaks and see if your company or you are in there and start your own class actions.
Absolutely. And remember what happened in Oklahoma City when Charles Keyes formed the citizen grand jury.
And the lawyers sued, and we found out exactly who blew the building up. We even know their names.
Exactly. So how about some citizen grand juries around the country empowering themselves to make a case, their case, against the Clintons and what?
And then those get delivered to real grand juries or state houses, and a lot of times cause a real investigation. It's a mock event, but it has the effect. And they can also have some legal effect. Monica, thank you for holding. You're a real trooper. I've been out of control today. But we're going to send Monica any type of nutraceutical she wants. Let's get her address, John. That's a hassle. Let's do it. Monica, thank you for calling today from Canada.
Hi. Oh, thanks for having me. I've got two observations as a Canadian and a question for you, because sure. We're on pins and needles with this question. First of all, the observation is the elitists. I live in Western Canada, Alberta, the province of oil, and they shut down our oil fields. The elitists shut down our oil fields. And why we know this is that the East, Canadian East, is shipping oil from Venezuela and Saudi Arabia, and yet they shut down the Alberta oil.
Well, you know who did that again? It's Soros again, because he controls with Berkshire Hathaway and the guy that owns that, all of the major railways that are involved there, Warren Buffett. I mean, you can't make this up.
And Trump was the first one to address, hey, why is OPEC, running our oil? And that's Saudi. But anyway, that's my first
Isn't topic. It great how Trump is right on like 99% of stuff? He isn't out to screw us.
No. And, he's going to, what happens in the States affects Canadians. People don't believe.
Ma'am, it was Soros and Berkshire Hathaway, Warren Buffett, that spent, it was like $50 million over the last 6 years killing the pipeline for your oil to come to us all the way down. They made all these rules where it has to be shipped in, again, as you said, by tanker and then on their trains, which is a tax where they tax everybody all the way over across Canada in the East. But there are all these liberals not even knowing there's an invisible Berkshire Hathaway tax, George Soros tax. See, that's what I mean. Everything we look at, these people are involved scamming us. Rappaport?
Oh, and
yeah, I mean, they're taking, here's my piece, and then I get another piece here, and I get another piece here, and I get another piece here. But, of course, I'm a socialist. I'm a great guy. I want equal treatment for everybody as long as I can keep taking my piece here, my piece there, my piece here, my piece there, right? So there's Soros funding MoveOn.org that's organizing whatever it is, 200 violent demonstrations.
He funds the fake environmental
right
groups
now.
With well-meaning Hollywood folks tying themselves to pipelines. They have no idea what they're doing.
No.
Ma'am, absolutely. Go ahead. Anything else?
Yes. In WikiLeaks yesterday, it was the first part of the very first thing out of WikiLeaks tying our prime minister to Podesta. Our prime minister was asking the Clintons to write his speech before he got elected.
I know.
So you can't tell us that the elitists are running Canada worse than the state.
Well, I run a pretty good size operation, and you know, my kids sometimes say, help me on homework, and I'm like, can you just write your own article? I can't imagine Hillary and her staff were like writing the New York Times, Washington Post, Canadian, you know, premieres. Just they do work like demons, John.
Yeah, they do. They work like demons because they have to try to, you know, it's like people are running after you and you have to keep on running in order to stay ahead. And that's what the Clintons have been doing for at least 30 years, is trying to stay ahead of prosecution for crimes. And they're continuing to run. Hillary figured, well, the best way to do this is to walk into the Oval Office and take over, because then I can really get rid of all the people that are chasing me. But that didn't work out. And so now they would like to slink away. But as we just discussed, that should not be in the cards. They should be right in the spotlight. Here's the new attorney general. Here's
it's the right thing to do, and it keeps the heat off of our America agenda. He's got to do it. He's got to do it. We have to go on full offense. Look, they're activating the Soros crowds. The buses, we caught the buses last night on tape. This is all Hillary. She's still attacking. She's not being conciliatory. Great points, Monica. God bless you. Appreciate your call. Justin, David, VC and others, your calls are only 3 minutes away. On the other side of this quick break, I'm Alex Jones. Don't forget, it is your support of this broadcast that makes it possible. So I want to salute you and thank you. Free shipping store-wide through this Sunday and the biggest discounts ever. All right, he'll be riding the shotgun with us 30 minutes to the next hour. Owen Schroyer, one of our great reporters, is going to be co-hosting with me. Let me take it over at the bottom of the next hour. We're going to your phone calls right now. John Rappaport is our guest. When we talk with John a little bit the next hour, it'll be about how he thinks they will counter-strike, but looking into the future, what the new biggest threats are. Because I want to savor this victory. But within hours, the globalists had launched their riots. Now the buses are coming in. It's the MoveOn.org. It's the Soros people. We've seen the WikiLeaks. We know their tactics. We know it's them. They're going into high gear to further try to divide the country. This is a big repudiation of that. But they're only doubling down. Is that because that's the only tactic they know? Or is it because down the road, they believe demographically, if they can turn different groups of people against each other, that's the only way the elite can rule? I want to go to calls right before, but just briefly, this looks like stupidity to me. I mean, I think their calculus is wrong. They thought they were going to win here. A civil war is going to blow up in their face as well. I mean, I've looked at the topography of this, and all the real folks that are working and successful, I don't care what color they are, want no part of a civil war or shooting police in the back of the head.
That's right. It's going to do the same thing that happened to them during the election campaign. It's going to jump right back at them, because millions of people are going to say, what is that? I don't want that. I don't want this, certainly any place near me, and I've got friends all over the country. They don't want it either. What is this? We don't want it. It's not productive. It's not asking for something that we, you know, we can solve problems without this. We don't need this.
Well, John, I can tell this is hurting you, so you're trying to think of solutions, and I agree too, but it's the worst I've ever seen it. It happened to me twice yesterday. It's happened to everybody I know that's basically white, especially white women. I guess there's some, you know, they're seen as weak. Folks are coming over and like really bugging their eyes out, asking, are you a Trump supporter? And some people are saying, yeah, and they're getting beaten. This is really shameful. I mean, I'm wondering what type of mind control MSNBC has been able to have, and just how shameful. Do they have any shame over there, what they've done?
No, absolutely not. None of these media outlets do. They're just covertly trying to stir up civil unrest, civil war.
Can you imagine if I got up here and said, black people are out to get you, and you just see any of them out there, you need to, you know, beat them up. I mean, that's what Newsweek and Time, remember they said last year, they said it's time to burn cities.
Right,
I mean, exactly. What, burn your own town? I mean, what the hell is this?
It's complete insanity. That's their agenda. That's what, I mean, these reporters and these editors, and I've been around them long enough to
understand. No, you've worked at major newspapers as an investigator.
So what do? They pick up a paycheck. They know what they're supposed to do, and they do it. They know if they don't do what they're supposed to do, they're out. They are, one thing that mainstream reporters are very good at is detecting which way the winds are blowing and what they're supposed to say and what they're supposed to do. And they can do it. That's their skill. Okay, now the trend is saying this. Now we have to go in that direction. That's what the bosses want. That's what I'm here to do. I'm a sellout, basically, as one reporter said on WikiLeaks. Hey, I'm a hack. Tell me what to do and I'll do it. Well, that's what they all are. They're all hacks. They're all waiting to be told what to do. And so
I have
now,
so many guests on and they go, hey, you didn't want to do a pre-interview or tell me what I could talk about. What do you want me on about? And I say, you're just an interesting person. I just want you on. And then a lot of times they think it's like a sneak attack. They go, really? What are you planning to ask me? And I'm like, I don't know. I just read your book. Thought it was interesting. I mean, we don't ever do pre-interviews with you.
No.
I mean, it's just, you're a smart guy. Interesting. I want to hear what you have to say. It's like coming over to your friend's house to have a beer. It's like, well, what do you want to talk about when you get here?
Yeah,
well,
we don't need the agenda.
The agenda is freedom, folks. The agenda is building a better world. And there really are good people. We'll be back. I promise. 70 seconds. We're going right to Justin. We're going right to all these other callers. Fourth hour, Infowars.com/show. Get the new free app. All right. Now, I'm going to do this hour. And Owen Schroyer was going to host the fourth hour, but I'm all hyped up. I'm going to be here too. But I have to have a quick meeting for 5 minutes during this break after we take some calls to check off a few things that have to be done right now, managing some things. I'm going to come back in and I'll be in the guest seat. And we're going to be talking to John Rappaport of NoMoreFakeNews.com. About future threats, bigger fights, what he sees down the road. Because, again, all these space cadet folks think if I bring something up negative, it's meant to depress them or make them feel powerless. No, it's so you know what's coming so we can defeat it. But, again, the jellyfish never mattered. I'm here raising the alarm for folks that do care. And I misunderstood a lot of this earlier in life. I'm going to talk about that a little bit later on the broadcast. But I just saw the state as the vehicle of the elites, so I always saw it as bad. And a big state is always bad. But then I thought maybe the enforcers are really bad because that's how the state will try to make me do this. But it's enforcers, even though they have problems historically, that are willing to put themselves on the line and who do live in the real world. And so those were the very people that were actually listening to me and actually responding on average the most, even though I was critical of them and didn't understand it all. They'd laugh at me and say, you'll get it down the road. And now, as I've experienced more and more of this, my knowledge base has clicked. And I just wonder, you know, as we get older, if we go down the path of knowledge, I mean, does it get just better and better, John Rappaport?
I think it does. Absolutely. And one of the big things up the road we have to look at here, Alex, is the trade treaties. I mean, Obama is going to try to ram the TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, through during the lame duck session of Congress. This is another one of these big globalist trade treaties. People have certainly heard
about it. Then let's get to that in the rest of the hour. You're awesome. Let's go to a call. I'm being a pig here with John. I want to take some calls. John in Florida, you're on the air. Thanks for holding. John, are you there, my friend? Or Justin in Florida, go ahead.
Yeah, I'm here.
Welcome, go ahead.
Justin. Hey, thanks for having me on. I appreciate it. So basically I have some solutions on, you know, and I'm glad that you guys brought up the topic of solutions. Because, you know, at this time, we know America wants justice. And, you know, a citizen's grand jury, like you guys have mentioned, would be great, but most people just don't know how to do that or how to get that started. And a lot of them I can talk about on the air, but some of them I really can't. So we may have, if you want to talk further on those at a later time, we'll do that.
Well, you're on the air live, brother, so if you want to, you know, I mean, give us some of your ideas for solutions. All I know is this. Pull our money out of big corporate institutions that are globalist. Support independent media and culture. Reach out to people. Educate people. And you know, have organic farms. Buy American. Expose the globalist agenda. I mean, what else can we do?
Yeah, I mean, I like those ideas. I'm thinking some Trump-sponsored outreaches to where we're getting into the community now. When he came to Florida, he drew a huge crowd. When he went, everywhere he went in the United States, he drew a huge crowd. So it's not a problem of getting people together to go out and spread the word and keep spreading the word and keep doing the job that we need done. But we need to stay connected with real people. You know, we need to make sure that our new president, which my new president is Donald J. Trump, and we need to be sure that...
I agree. And John Rappaport, what about this? I think Trump should do, because he's such a workhorse, maybe a week-long 25-city tour where he goes directly into these blue zones, directly into the sanctuary cities, and just says, look, if there's felons in your town, we need them out. We're saying You have to be here legally. That's common sense. Mexico does that. China does that. But I want to bring jobs here. I want to build you up. I'm your friend. These Democrats are just basically keeping you as a permanent undocumented underclass.
If he does that, suddenly there's going to be visible people that have been invisible for a long time. I'm not talking about the people who are illegals in the sanctuary cities. I'm talking about people that are out of work. People who have been thrown out of work by the globalists, they're going to start showing up, and he's going to be talking to them.
And that's the big game changer.
They're
that's the key.
They're going to become visible.
That's why Trump knew he'd win. We're getting people of every race, color, and creed that were disenfranchised and not even in the system to come back. We'll be right back. Great points, Justin. More calls straight ahead.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. We are in the fourth hour. Owen Schroyer filling in here. Alex will be rejoining us here momentarily. John Rappaport still with us of NoMoreFakeNews.com. And it's very important, folks. We need to remember this. We need to continue to harp this. We need to continue to preach this. We need to continue to sing this. We won. And it's not just about Donald Trump. It's the fact that we beat the mainstream news. We beat Obama. We beat the Pope. We beat all of these fake leaders who told us we couldn't have Trump, said there's no way Trump could win, tried to brainwash us into thinking Trump could never win. We beat all of them. And I know that we got to get back to fighting the good fight here. We got to deal with these protesters that we all expected would kick off, but we beat them. We beat them. And I think that it's okay for us to take some solace in that fact and to take some time to actually enjoy that. And I'm curious, you know, John, what are you thinking right now as we've entered this time where we're looking at perhaps we're taking back the narrative, we're taking back the reality, and still, though, we're facing this backlash with the mainstream media continuing to shovel out nonsense, the brainwashed protesters going out on the streets and protesting. How does this come to a head, do you think, John Rappaport? And is there an end in sight?
What I see is the seesaw has shifted tremendously. As Alex and I were talking in the last hour, alternative media, as people like to call it, is on such a rise now, is expanded to such an incredible degree that major media just don't know what to do. They just don't know how to deal with it. They don't talk about it, it expands anyway. They talk about it, it gets bigger, even bigger. That, fueled with, however you want to look at it, the victory of Trump or the defeat of Hillary, is now throwing the whole globalist agenda into grave doubt. So we have tremendous victories on our side right now, and we have to inject, as a friend of mine was saying to me yesterday, real solutions into this mix, and we can do it, and they will be noticed because the size of the alternative media is now so powerful. It's not like somebody off in a corner saying, hey, Mr. President, I've got this idea, and so, no. This is gigantic. Websites all over the world that are reporting news, actual news, truthful news, are blowing up. It's huge.
Well, and you
think
about
if we talk about solutions here, for example, millions of people already hear about it, and and Trump notices it, Roger Stone notices it, all kinds of people notice it, not just the incoming president. It's having a huge effect now.
And the crazy thing, or I guess the difference is, you know, our audience is actually engaged. Our audience is actually active. They'll go out, they'll build a garden. They'll go out, they'll make a health product to fight the fluoride in the water. Whereas, so we're ingesting solutions, or we're injecting solutions, as you said, but you think about the other side of the spectrum, the CNN audience, the MSNBC audience, what are they doing? What's their solution? They're out in the streets protesting. They're burning American flags. Zombies. They're starting fires.
Zombies. They're just sitting there. You know, that's the other thing they're doing. Zombie land. Uh-huh, the news, here we go, okay, it's the news again, oh, look at that, oh, yeah, okay, that's the end of the news, whew. Okay, and then tomorrow they do the same thing. Here's talking about solutions. Health freedom. as I said to Alex in the last hour, a couple of states some years ago passed laws that said, no matter what kind of practitioner you are, health practitioner, if you're treating a person for a condition with a remedy that is no more harmful than the medical remedy for the same condition, you're home free. Nobody can do anything to you. That's a pretty good idea. Now, just imagine for a moment that some state, roll the dice, who cares what it is, let's say South Carolina, decides that they're going to pass that and they're going to back it up, no matter what the medical authorities say. Health freedom. What happens? All manner of health practitioners from all over the country, including the best of the best, move to South Carolina and set up shop. Not only that, but their clients and potential clients and all kinds of people that want natural health move to South Carolina because they know they can get it and it's going to be free of government intervention. Now, South Carolina's economy is booming in a way that it's never boomed before. That's called a solution. That's called freedom. That's called the kind of thing that could be encouraged by this incoming administration. Just on the basis of economics alone, do you want to make your state extremely prosperous? Think about this. No harm, no foul. You've got chiropractors, acupuncturists, herbalists, nutritionists of all stripes, and so on and so forth. Forget about the dietitians and all these other organizations and the medical idiots and boards that are trying to enforce everything on everybody and destroy their freedom. No, we're going to pass a law. You guys are out of it. You do what you want to. Everybody else can do what they want to. And the economy is going to blow up in whatever state decides to do that. That's called the free market.
And I think one of the biggest solutions is just already happening organically, where people are just finally engaged. They're finally getting informed. It's not just the drive-by media audience. It's not just the people who supported Obama. I mean, where have they been for the last 8 years? They haven't held Obama's feet to the fire on any of the promises he broke. I guarantee you, if Trump goes sideways, the first minute he goes sideways, all the people that voted for Trump will be on him. The media is going to be on him the entire time anyway. We'll be on him. So I think that that's a solution here that's just kind of already ingrained into the election of Trump, into the Trump movement that we're already seeing, where Americans are starting to care about the country. They're starting to see what the real threats to the future of this country were, and they're identifying them. And that's why we've elected Trump into office, despite everything that they've tried to wage to keep him out of office. I want to go to a couple more callers. These guys have been kind enough to wait for hours just to come on this show. Let's go to David in Nevada, who wants to talk about the zombie-like quality of the protesters. Go ahead, David.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, can you hear me? Can you hear me, Owen?
Oh, I can hear you loud and clear, David.
Okay, great. Yeah. Hey, did you see those protesters this morning?
Which ones exactly? The ones burning the American flag? Those disgraceful protesters?
Look at all of them. Look at the different ones. And look in their eyes.
Well, look, here's the deal. Here's the deal, David. Okay. I mean, I'm sure that you've seen the videos that I've done where I go out on the streets and I confront these protesters, folks. This is not a theory. We've proven this time and time again. The protesters against Trump are the dumbest, most brainwashed, ignorant, misinformed people you're ever going to meet in your life. I'm sorry. I'm not trying to be mean. I'm calling a spade a spade. These are the dumbest, most brainwashed people that can't even answer a simple question. Okay? So we're not making this up. I'm not sitting here demonizing Trump protesters because I'm a Trump voter. No, I went and tried to engage with these people. They are complete morons. I'm sorry. Go ahead, David.
Yeah, well, and the rabbit hole goes even deeper than you imagine, because they actually are literally zombies.
Well, here's the thing. They're zombified by the television. They're zombified by the television. They're taking fluoride their whole life. It's the hearsay mafia. And you know what the funny thing is about it? So these are college students, right? These are the majority of these protesters are college students. Of course, they don't want to go to class. Well, who wants an education? There's no future for me anyway. What's the point of going to class? I'm just going to spend, you know, tens of thousands of dollars for this higher education, and then I'm just going to protest my way through college. But guess what? The teachers, the faculty, the administrators are right in there with them. They're leading the protests even. John Rappaport.
I used to be a teacher, so I can talk to this specifically. That's right. You take three or four generations of teachers and dumb them down continually to the point where they can't even teach their own subject competently and don't want to. So what are they going to do? Any excuse to let the kids out is going to be great for them.
Yeah.
Any ideas that they can stick into their heads or values, as opposed to actually saying, okay, we have to open our books now, kids. Here's page 132, and we're going to go over this until everybody understands it. For a lot of teachers now, that's too much. They can't do it. They weren't raised that way. They weren't educated that way. So much easier to say, now we're going to talk about getting along with each other. Now we're going to talk about different colors and ethnicities and this and that and sexual orientation and all the insane values that they have no business discussing in public schools. And they're going to do it because it's the easy way out, frankly. It's easier for them to do that. And so, oh, there's a protest? Okay, let's go.
Exactly.
A free day off and I get paid.
And that's not a solution. What is that a solution to? What is a protest going to do, folks? It's done nothing. These people have been protesting for years now. Black Lives Matter has been protesting for years. The anti-Trump protesters have been protesting for over a year. What have you accomplished? You've accomplished nothing. Actually, I'll correct myself. You did accomplish something. You helped get Donald Trump elected. And see, they don't even realize it. They're eating their own garbage. They're sitting here eating their own garbage that they can't even see that they helped get Donald Trump elected, because reasonable, logical people saw who the anti-Trump protesters were, and then they got scared that these are the people in control of the future, and they ran to the polls to vote for Donald Trump. So thank you very much. But it's funny, you know, here's a story. Photos, LA street artist moving sale posters for anti-Trump celebrities. Cher, Sam Jackson, all these celebrities who said they were going to be leaving when Donald Trump wins. Let's hold them to it. Amy Schumer, goodbye. Good riddance. And now there's fake ads on these benches in California. This is brilliant. The street artist that made this with Donald Trump on there. Cher's house is up for sale. Samuel Jackson's house is up for sale. We'll be right back. Fourth hour, Alex Jones Show. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. Alex Jones has just rejoined us. We're going to talk more with John Rapoport. We're going to talk about future threats, coming threats, protests. And again, though, I think it's worth starting every segment with this. I'd like to know what Alex thinks about this as he rejoins us. And we're going to play a clip from RT here in a second talking about this. But Alex, we beat the mainstream media. We beat Obama. We beat the protesters. We beat the Pope. We beat the corrupt establishment.
The communist Chinese president.
That told us we could not have Trump.
We beat the kitchen sink.
So it's time to just let them know we beat you. Quit trying. But here's RT talking about American media having to walk back the embarrassment that was their election coverage.
Can it get any more awkward than this?
USA! USA!
Thank you. Around the world, the politicians, journalists, and diplomats who branded Donald Trump racist and right-wing are having to backpedal. British Foreign Secretary Boris Johnson is one of them. Back when he was mayor of London, he said there were parts of New York he'd be afraid to go to for fear of bumping into Donald Trump. Now he's Britain's top diplomat. Johnson says he's very much looking forward to working with him. Over in the Republic of Ireland, it's the defense minister who's on the defensive. Before Trump became the Republican nominee, Enda Kelly branded Trump racist and dangerous. But now he's heading for the White House.
I listened very carefully to the president-elect this morning. Very happy that the government will work with the new administration when appointed by the president-elect.
The bigwigs in Brussels are also shifting into reverse gear. Days before voters cast their ballots, European Council President Donald Tusk tweeted this.
My wife's latest comment, one Donald is more than enough.
By Wednesday, though, the olive branches were out, or at least invitations for Trump to come to an EU-US summit as soon as possible. NATO's former Secretary General, too, changed his tune once the results were in.
We don't know what will be the concrete policies of a Trump administration. I think they could be very dangerous for the world. I congratulate Donald Trump on the election victory. His administration must display global leadership and defend friends and allies.
Global leadership means opening your borders up, my friends.
Word in diplomatic circles.
Yeah, hand it over to the globalists. That's the global leadership.
Let jihadis poop in the public pools.
Just wipe your social media
and then
timeline.
And then kids and say it's okay, it's tolerance.
The first to congratulate Trump on his win was British Prime Minister Theresa May, perhaps to make amends for her predecessor labeling Trump stupid, divisive, and wrong over comments about stopping Muslims entering the U.S. Despite Theresa May's diplomacy...
Look, these are people that just run around stealing money all day and wrecking economies, and then all they just go, racist, 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 and hop around. I mean, that's all they've got.
The country where so many citizens signed a petition trying to ban Trump from entering that Parliament was forced to debate the issue. And politicians...
But it showed the total intimidation they were involved in. We'll take a few final calls here after the break. As people have been holding. We're going to go to VC and a few others that have been holding a really long time. Ivy and Hunter and Jeremiah and Jason. But this is a short segment. A total repudiation. It shows their arrogance. It shows their disconnect. And it shows, though, I don't think they're going to stop. I think they're going to counter-strike back.
Well, and this shows the nature, the shill nature of these politicians, too. They will say and do anything to just stay in office. That's all they care about. They don't care about the countries that they represent. They don't care about the economies they claim to want to fix. They don't care about the borders. They don't.
John Rappaport, isn't it refreshing to just to know that Trump isn't perfect, but he is his own man and pig-headed? I mean, that's his crime. He's not from this big swarm of locusts. Globalists that are a minority worldwide, but from every country, religion, and race, but have decided they rule the earth. They're now getting a rude awakening that no, you don't. You snuck in with globalism, corporate conquest. Now we're aware of the conquest. It's illegitimate. It's illegal. It doesn't work. It sucks. Guess what? This is just the beginning. You're losing on every front. Go ahead and try to hold us hostage. Go ahead and blow up our economy like you threatened with Brexit or this. Watch what happens. We'll arrest your ass. Go ahead.
So what happens now when a couple of these trade treaties get struck down? Bang. All of a sudden, the globalist plan to increase corporate domination over the world and set up corporate tribunals instead of court systems in sovereign nations goes down the toilet. Now, when that happens, that is going to be a major blow against the empire. That would be, okay, we said we were coming to Washington to get rid of globalism. Here's one of their major, major pieces, and we just killed it like a fly. Like
NAFTA, GATT, TPP.
TPP, TTIP, CAFTA, you know, the whole world, WTO, expose the entire...
And they've all engaged in racketeering to get these things done secret, so if they don't go along... with us restoring the republic and free and fair trade, oh, there'll have to be indictments against all of them.
And if we got a RICO investigation on this deal, look out.
All right, and Rappaport was already faded out. He said, absolutely. They've committed crimes. It's time to prosecute the white-collar criminals. Careful what you wish. You might just get it. And that's what was at a big state party in Russia yesterday after Trump, one of your TV viewers. It's two tough guy images in a Russian painting of Vladimir Putin and Donald Trump. Is that just the humor level of this is really good. And I think somebody put up a screen of a fake red square during the Soviet era. We've now been captured by Russia, folks. Now get ready.
Wait a second.
For Donald Trump to try to cut your taxes by...
What's that, Putin? What?
100% of you make $140,000 a year is what it comes out to. And everybody else, huge tax cuts, which will cause more tax receipts to come in. So if we just... keep spending the same, it'll pay off. Problem was, Reagan let them double and triple spending. It doubled tax increases again, revenue, but they increased spending way more. The answer is leave it the same, cut taxes to the people, bring all the corporate money back, and we're off the races. Let's take a few phone calls here. John Rappaport is riding shotgun with us. We're coming from the InfoWars News Centers in Austin, Texas. Stupendous, mega massive victories for humanity so far, but the enemy is striking back. Imagine there's going to be riots and attacks and more racial garbage all night long, but most Americans of every race, color, and creed see right through it. Who's been holding the longest? Let me see here. VC in Texas, you're on the air.
Oh, Alex, it's great to talk to you, man. Listen, you're doing a fantastic job. Your crew, it's unbelievable. I mean, I've been a political junkie since 79 when C-SPAN started up. I grew up in the Vietnam era and Watergate, so it's only natural for people to get caught up in their own political climates. And so I really never caught on to the Republican Party very much. And but I very much supported Ross Perot. Thought he was great. That was a great hope.
Boy, I wish we had listened to him. But didn't Al Gore turn out to be a complete liar?
You know, and see, I supported Gore when he came up in his thing because I didn't like Bush. I thought there's too much military-industrial complex. And, you know, I wish I could be a citizen caller that could call in and talk to you for an hour's airtime because there's so much filled up inside me, man. You've got me amped up on this political process here. And, you know, I could go over it all. I mean, I supported Obama in 2008, and what a disastrous mistake that was. But I grew up here in Austin. I went to Anderson, the same high school you did. I grew up in that area west of...
Wait a minute. I went to school in Russia.
Yeah.
You were classmates with Putin, weren't you?
Actually, I'm Vladimir Putin's son.
Yeah, I can see the resemblance, Alex.
I'm sorry. Go ahead, sir.
I was in there probably before you, well before you were, but you probably had Buford as your principal. But anyway, let me go on to the thing is that Trump, I'm just very, very concerned that he's going to be co-opted. I mean, he's an instigator. You know, he is the rebel within the Republican Party. I loved a lot of Ron Paul's ideas and things like that. They're going to try to co-opt him, and I think it's great that he supposedly has been listening to you for all these years, but you look at already some of his advisors and stuff who surround him.
No, I hear you. There are some issues with people like Newt Gingrich, but let's go to that with John Rappaport. Let me explain something. Some of Trump's kids have listened. Trump knows who I am. I've talked to Trump some. Our movement, when he goes to events and a third of the people are wearing Hillary for President shirts and our listeners are there, he's picking up on all that, and it's meshing with his populism. So let's get it clear. Donald Trump is not some Alex Jones bot. The American people are rediscovering Americana. I didn't write up this whole cosmology. We're covering things that are factual and already there. But that's a good point. How do we keep Trump honest, John Rappaport?
First time we see it out of the box that somebody really bad gets appointed. Outrage, uproar, wrong move. This is an insider. This is somebody who's just a holdover from Bush. This is a neocon. You don't need this guy. You don't want this guy. Who told you to appoint this guy? Let's run it down. I make the distinction between two things with presidential appointees. Yeah, you need people who know how the game is played in Washington, the details and the ins and the outs of the official game and the unofficial game. Sure, it's a big city with a mega complex bureaucracy. But those people should just be there to give you technical data and advice on procedure.
Great point. They should. This is excellent. They shouldn't be running anything. They just have the blueprint.
You never put them in charge of anything. They're just there in a kind of a robotic way. Okay, Joe, so what's happening right here now? Okay, well, this is what's happening, and he's here, and that's there. Okay, thank you, Joe. Go back to your cubbyhole. Now we decide what we're going to do. Joe never becomes the department chairman.
Gatekeeper.
Exactly. So that's what we have to watch out for. And to me, this is one of the caller's absolutely right. This is the key. If he's going to surround himself with the same old tired people, there's going to be major trouble. Major trouble. This cannot happen, and we have to watch it.
I agree. The good news is the few people he has gotten from the establishment, he's used as like a tour guide until he figures this out. I mean, that was my old joke about he's got to go into a goblin's nest. He needs a guide to take him into the goblin's nest. And if he uses these people just as guides, that's fine. But if we, catch him kissing goblins, if we catch him in bed with a goblin, you know, that is not going to be a good thing. But to be serious, they turn that into this huge, you know, Vine, huge viral deal with 20 million views or something, that particular joke, editing it together. But he really got there by being outside the box. He changed the whole system. He recognized that time of change had come. He recognized a rotting, empty media. I mean, he really did show incredible instincts in what he's done and being able to gauge and tune in to the ether, John.
Yeah, no question about it. And as I keep saying, he ran his campaign against the media. That was the smartest thing he did right from the get-go, because he never could have gotten his message across if he had played ball with the media on any
exactly,
level.
And he won't get the agenda through now playing ball. And the one thing I don't like, I bitched about it as he said it live, he's like, oh, thank you, Hillary, really all owe you a great debt. That's the first time I've heard him lie in the campaign. And I get being gracious, wanting to not have a stock market crash, wanting to be like the big guy. They still kept attacking within minutes like piranha. I would have just said, well, we're the winner. Too bad we haven't seen a public concession. Justice will be done. We're going to move forward. I'm a president for all Americans. You've heard a bunch of lies from the media. Now you're going to be able to hear me with daily briefings to you about what's really happening. And we're going to restore this country, but we've been infiltrated by a lot of foreign multinational interests. So I have to let you know that the work has just begun. We've only gotten a beachhead now in the retaking of America. I want to thank you all for everything you've done and your support. This is the return of 1776. God bless you all.
Exactly. And when you talk about daily briefings, that's it. That's it right there. Because he's up against a tsunami. So daily briefings mean to me, and this should be a clue to him. Okay, folks, this is what happened today. I want to tell you straight out. These are the people I met with. This is where we met. This was on the agenda. This is what I told them that I want. And this is what they came back at me with. These are the people that are blocking why you put me here.
I think you just ought to have all the summits live and all his major meetings just be revolutionary on C-SPAN.
I think that's actually a great idea, and that would get more people to be tuned into what the government's doing. And to the caller's point, I don't know if you saw this story. Trump makes first White House visit as president-elect. Trump actually visited the White House.
Yeah, let's show some of that video. It's him pulling up earlier today. We can Google that.
And this is what Obama said. I believe that this is important for all of us, regardless of party, political preferences, to come together, work together, and deal with many challenges we face. I want to emphasize to you, Mr. President-elect, that we now are going to want to do everything we can to help you succeed, because if you succeed, the country succeeds. But I'm just curious, where are the protesters? Why aren't they listening to Obama on that and getting out?
They're following the $500 a day they get from George Soros. Look. Dude was down there, like, they had hundreds of buses, hundreds. Buses were blocking roads, bringing him into riot.
Well, and they're already planning on protesting on January 20th. We've got Facebook groups being made. I've got some flyers. We can cover that later. But then Trump said, in his conversation with Obama, I can only imagine after the things that Obama and Trump have said about each other during this campaign, how that conversation went out of the cameras. We discussed a lot of different situations, some wonderful and some difficulties. I'm very much looking forward to dealing with the president in the future, including counsel. Mr. President, it was a great honor meeting with you, and I look forward to meeting with you many, many more times in the future. So perhaps this is the first time maybe we look at Trump and say, hey, why are you cozying up to Obama? But again, you know, with this, with the things that Trump is saying.
I'm just saying something right now. I don't like Obama, but his body language is better with Trump than it is around Hillary. He does not like Hillary.
Well, Hillary is just, I mean, I couldn't even imagine what my body language would be like around Hillary, honestly. I don't know. I don't want to know. But remember, it was Obama and it was Hillary who were sitting here reminding Trump, pointing the finger at Trump, you need to make sure the transition of power is peaceful. This is a tradition in this country, transition of power peaceful. But then what do we see from the Obama and Hillary supporters? Violent protests in the street, burning flags, and nothing from Obama, nothing from Hillary. I guess this is the first time Obama's basically said, hey, let's work together, let's come together.
I agree. That would signal that they were backing off. But the fact we don't hear any repudiation of this, and I mean, give me a break, man. If you're going to wave flags, wave something like the Swiss flag that's successful, or something else, or a Christian flag. They're like commie flags. Alex, communists can't even produce automobiles.
They're waving Mexican flags saying Donald Trump is not my president. Well, duh, he's the president of the United States, not Mexico. What is, these people have no logic. There's no train of thought.
Well, it's all the liberation theology crap they've been taught. And I mean, this is absolutely the U.S. pissed on Mexico and back and forth. There were freaking six flags over Texas, like eight flags over California. The Russians used to have California. I mean, it's a damn war over here. Nobody could take this from the Comanches. That's why it was the Texans finally did. And they say, oh, we killed all the Comanches. No, everybody just got basically intermarried. I mean, it's just the realities have all been totally distorted. I want to hit a few calls. Here, doing a great job today, everybody. John Rappaport, other future threats you see. We've covered them here. I mean, we're hitting a lot of them here. I'm worried about assassination of Trump. I know he's for real. I mean, he's perfect, but he's for real. He's not under globalist control. He's not a Satanist. He's not out to get people. He wants prosperity. He's a little bit authoritarian, a little bit classic alpha male strongman. That's why he and Pooty Poot like each other. I don't want to be under a Pooty Poot strongman. And I get Pooty Poot had to be strong to get the globalist out, but, you know, whatever. I'm really concerned, though, they're going to try to kill Trump.
Sure, it's possible. No question about it. I mean, it's a time-honored tradition. Somebody goes up against the established power, you get rid of them. So that's always a concern. Absolutely.
But can't the established power look at the tea leaves and say, we don't want to be dumb like Hitler in the bunker. We want to give up long before that. Everything we do, we're losing. Brexit, Russia here, Catalonia, on and on and on. Iceland. We've got to start pulling back. Because even the globalists and some of their publications admit that aren't even public. I mean, you can get them, but they're not distributed widely. We really did screw everybody. Globalism really did make everybody poor but us. Our money won't be worth anything in most places. If society collapses, we might want to actually back off this. So there's even discussions of, like Stiglitz, the former head of the World Bank, for 15 years he's been saying, we got to stop this.
Yeah, there is some discussion of it, but they're not going to back off at the highest levels of globalism because they built a structure to rule the world. I mean, the structure's already there. They're not going to just say, okay, guys, let's tear it down because, we're causing too much trouble. They are causing too much trouble. And one of the things that's going to be happening quite soon, if not already, is that CEOs of major corporations are going to be going to the big Rockefeller globalists and saying, hey, guess what? Our consumer base is shrinking around the world. You said that if we played your game, that we could be selling more products to everybody, and it's not working out. So what's going on here? There are divisions within globalism, no question about it. My main concern is with the intricacies of the Washington power structure and what happens when Trump gets into that and tries to solve that and work through it to push through basic. I mean,
he's going to have to be nice to the ones that are nice, mean to the ones that are recalcitrant, follow the Constitution, go to the public with a bully pulpit, and he has to run over everyone that threatens him or tries to play kingpin. He has to run these bastards over. And then when one of them plays a game or does a dirty trick, oh, guess what? You committed all these crimes previously. You've been indicted. And look, this isn't my call for authoritarianism. This is a foreign authoritarian group, okay? So they're lucky we're not like the French with De Gaulle kicking, NATO out and trying to control France. They're lucky we don't have paratroopers running up arresting all the CEOs right now, okay? And I'm not calling for that, but they're the ones that occupied us. So if they don't back off, the gloves come off. John?
Yeah, sure. let's go. I'm ready for that anytime. The thing is, what Trump is saying and what the people behind him want him to do are very simple things. These are not rocket science type things. So you
and here's the deal. We're done calling bluffs.
And everybody's going to say in Washington, Mr. President, you don't really understand how things run here. I mean, what you're trying to do is to light a fire in a structure that's, 5 million stories high, and you've got to go up to this floor and that floor and do this and do that and whatever, whatever. And he's got to keep his head straight.
And the lie is, it isn't really a structure. It's a big fraud built out of endless money and our blood, sweat, and tears. We need to demolition a lot of this stuff anyways.
Exactly. Exactly. I mean, I'd love to see him eliminate two or three cabinet posts and just throw everything.
I agree. The first thing he should do is go in and reorganize all those things, put agencies together, lay them off, man. Americans have been, D.C.'s the richest city in the world. They get fatter all the time. We're hurting. So until we start getting some wealth, and until our companies get built, and our industry, and our kids, and until we don't have the highest infant mortality in the frickin' industrialized world, you're out on your asses.
Well, and let's be clear, too, because I can already see this happening. If Donald Trump gets in and starts to drain the swamp like he talks about, this is not authoritarianism. This is not a dictator. This is a guy who's getting rid of the corrupt establishment.
He's got a mandate from the people who are in tens of thousands of emails, hundreds of thousands, bragging about how we're dumbasses and how they're robbing us and giggling and laughing, okay? So I want to see indictments. I want to see these people in prison.
And it will be shocking for the people who have been above the law in this country for decades to finally face justice. Of course it'll be shocking. And I can already see what the mainstream media will say. He's a dictator. He's an authoritarian. He's gone power crazy. So we need to be ahead of the curve on that.
Well, I mean, here's the problem. If he does just go in and try to play patty cake and try to get a few things done and let them all act like they're his friends now, he'll just drift off. We won't get half of what we need, and then we're done. He really wants to be on this crusade. These are globalist foreign operatives. We can absolutely, they've all committed major crimes, and it's time to prosecute them. And I'm serious. They either get out of the way and let us fix this country, or It's prison.
George Soros has been inciting violence around the world for years. This man should be in jail.
Yeah, I mean, here's the deal.
That's why at the top, Alex, when you and I started talking, that's what we're talking about.
The
prosecutions have to go forward. They can't stop now. This has to be part of the whole pattern here. You can't just say, well, and now we're going to have peace with everybody and everybody's
okay. Because they said next year they were going to shut down our free speech. They've been calling for my arrest.
Yeah, you can't slow down now.
Sorry, John, go ahead.
You have to prosecute these people. You have to arrest them. You have to put them in jail. You have to take them to court. You have to show the evidence and say, okay, massive numbers we're talking about here. You're out. You're prosecuted. You're out. You're prosecuted. I mean, that's what draining the swamp means, if that's what he really intends to do. And for the people that say, oh, this is sounds like the Soviet system. No.
By the way,
this whole thing was set up as an oppression to begin with. The whole bureaucratic system is criminal to begin with.
That's right. And if we just get, say, 10 of the kingpins.
Oppressed all this time.
If we just indict, say, 10 of the kingpins that we know are criminals, Hillary, you name it, all their minions will flip on them instantly. We'll get the entire Rolodex of crime. You think one guy's email brought them down? Mike, that's one little window, folks. We'll get the whole stinking mess. We'll roll up all of them. The pedophile rings, the devil worshipers. Man, there's going to be, oh, these guys are in trouble.
Here, look at this. Go to the FDA. Find three people that are willing to roll over because you've got evidence on them. And say, we want to know everything criminal that's been going on at the FDA with approving drugs that kill people.
Collusion with Monsanto.
Companies lying, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? That's what we want. Now, you can either go to jail for a year or you can go to jail for 30 years. So what are you going to do? And all of a sudden, like you say, everybody comes out of the woodwork. Confessions everywhere. Everybody rolls over on everybody else. This is how deep the corruption runs at all these agencies. So if you're going to move ahead, move ahead. Don't stop. Don't pretend it's all well and good, because it's not.
And here's the reason we have to move ahead. They've built a corrupt system antithetical to the American system, and they want to shut us down when we're not corrupt and are doing nothing wrong. So it's survival. They deserve it. They're evil. We've caught them. They're corrupt. People risked their lives and died to bring us the WikiLeaks. And it is. And listen, by up here leading a movement to have them arrested, you know, Hillary for president 2016, I'm not going to just give up now that we've had this level of victory. Because it means nothing if we win this victory and then lose down the road. We have to press. We have to do the right thing.
I still want Hillary in jail. Just because she didn't win the White House doesn't mean I don't want her in jail.
Of course. Of course, this is part of the deal. Like Alex said, look, they built this system, which is, as he said, antithetical to the original meaning of the Constitution and the country. That's what they did. They said, look, we don't care about severely limited central government. I mean, who cares about that? We want to rule the system, and the only way to do that is to keep making it bigger and bigger and bigger.
Here's where I'd start. We should have a mock trial and have everybody come to town and do this. We should start with the IRS, open and shut, persecuting Christians, conservatives, libertarians, putting people in jail. Even the New York Times admit this whole Hispanic American lady who had like a six-top counter and two tables for 50-something years. Her gross every day was like $400, $500. She made a couple hundred dollars, you know, a week. She lived in a tiny house. She deposited all her money in the bank every day religiously. Her life savings was $37,000. And the IRS said, we know you're innocent. We know there's no drugs. It's all accounted for. But under our regulations, it's structuring. And they took all her money. And then we're getting ready to prosecute her when Congress had an investigation or dropped it. And Congress found 50,000 cases in the previous year. And this is in the New York Times. Of other people totally. I mean, dude, they are sending IRS out to rob 79-year-old Hispanic grandmas of their life savings. Right. I mean, it's just like. Start there. IRS commissioner, you're going to frickin' prison, you witch.
Exactly. Move over to the CDC. Move over to the FDA. Terrific. Terrific.
All the internal CDC documents where they admit that they're causing autism and hurting people?
Of course. Bring freedom back. Bring choice back. Liberate people. This is what would happen if you did this.
We'd have a renaissance. We'd be rolling in wealth.
And people would walk down the street. They wouldn't even know why they feel better, but they would.
Well, that's how history actually works.
Yeah, that's a great point.
But yeah, the Renaissance, once it cranked up, and it was like hysteria. More development in 20 years than the last 100, and just books everywhere, and designs, and ships, and cathedrals, and dresses, and plays, and medicines, and inventions, and clocks being and just running around, just frothing.
That's the saddest part about this is... Right. The protesters, the people that hate Donald Trump, they're completely missing out on this history. They don't really know what's going on. They're being used like pawns in a game of chess. And
they got smartphones in their hands, the product of technology, bitching they're in the West. It's like a frickin' space station compared to every communist hellhole.
But it's like if you told
them, like wandering out bitching, and they say, oh, look at this civilization. Oh, God, it's so hard.
Trump's a misogynist. Really? Because Kellyanne Conway, his campaign manager, just became the first woman to successfully manage a campaign to victory. How's that for misogyny?
Who bought them TVs, bitch? Tell me that.
But here's the thing. They're completely missing it. They're going to continue to protest. They're going to have these huge protests January 20th on the inauguration day. So, Alex, I don't know if you actually heard this. Here's my idea. This is what we should do. If you want to steal this idea from me, that's perfectly fine because protests are breaking out all over the United States right now, mainly on the West Coast, happening in New York, Chicago. Here's what we're going to do to these protesters, folks. Get a box of diapers, get a box of Binkies, and we're going to throw diapers and Binkies at these people because that's all they are. They're babies.
Oh, no, worse, onesies.
Little onesies, but you get the illustration, right? They're babies. They're throwing temper
tantrums. We're trying to find Paul Watson's piece on that, where the psychologist likened them to toddlers.
That's what they are. And you've been saying it. It's arrested development, okay? And this is part of what has happened with the TV, the fluoride in the water, the fake food. You're eating fake food, folks. That's why these food.
Here's it. Let's hear some special reports on this.
Real food now. Real food.
I apologize to some of the callers. If you call back tomorrow, I promise I have the line, Jeremiah and others. But we got to most folks. I apologize. Great job, John Rappaport. NoMoreFakeNews.com. Please support him. Great books, great material over there. NoMoreFakeNews.com. He shoots some podcasts and videos as well. We'll have the nightly news back tonight, 7 o'clock Central. Lord willing, I'll be back tomorrow. Let me just add, we're running through the weekend, free shipping store-wide, and we're running 30 to 40% off on storable food. We've extended that, and 30% off on all the nutraceuticals at InfoWarsLife.com. So InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com, it's the same website, just InfoWarsLife.com takes you to the subsection. Those purchases make what we do here possible. We also have the Donald Trump is my president red shirt that we can wear for election day. It's limited edition. It's almost sold out. In fact, I'm told some sizes are going to be selling out in the next day or two. We're not remaking that. We're going to have a new deplorable style shirt coming out. But you want this limited edition. The Hillary for President is now history. We're still pushing for that, but these are limited edition. Trump is my president. We need to start wearing these openly and then strike up conversations with the folks that are upset and say, I love you. Under $40,000 a year. No taxes is his plan. You know, it's okay. You know, the big mega banks love Hillary. They don't love him. We need...
Yeah, he's stuck up for homosexual rights at golf clubs. He's stuck up for women's rights. He's put women...
That's why he's a homophobe. Be quiet, racist.
I mean...
racist.
You're an effing white male.
Yeah.
Shut up, white male.
Yeah, white male.
You're white male.
Anyways, the answer is prosperity, folks. That's what America's all about. We're not perfect. God knows that. InfoWarsStore.com, 888-253-3139. I want to thank the crew. The listeners, everybody, what a huge victory. The whole elite overthrown. They're total jokes. They're discredited. If we press the advantage and don't roll over and just think they're going to coexist, we'll be doing great. If we don't understand they're criminals that want to overthrow our coexist system, we're going to lose. But we have won a big battle. Savor it and understand there's a lot of anxiety here on the broadcast, but it's about getting awake to what's happening, mobilizing, and defeating it. So I salute you all. Thank Jesus Christ above, the good Lord. Nightly news tonight, 7 o'clock Central. We have some special events coming up today. Watch InfoWars.com.